Good morning and welcome to the first joint meeting in 2024 of members of the Criminal Justice, the Health, Social Care and Sport and the Social Justice and Social Security Committees to consider the progress made in implementing the recommendations of the Scottish Drug Death Task Force. So we have apologies this morning from Gillian Mackay, MSP and Sue Webber, MSP. So our first item of business is to decide whether to take item 3 in private, which is to review today's evidence. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So our main item of business today is to take evidence on the progress being made to tackle drug harm and reduce drugs deaths. And I'm pleased to welcome to our first panel of witnesses today. So a warm welcome to Kirsten Horsburgh, Chief Executive Officer at the Scottish Drugs Forum. Justina Murray, Chief Executive Officer of Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs, and Dr Emma Fletcher, Director of NHS Tayside Public Health and Chair of Dundee Alcohol and Drug Partnership. So well, welcome to you all. So I refer members to papers 1 and 2, and I thank witnesses for providing very helpful written submissions. So as ever, we'll move straight to questions, and I wonder if I can maybe just get things underway. And I'd like to ask you individual questions. And I'm going to come to Kirsten Horsburgh first of all, probably a bit of a big question, but obviously we're seeing reporting in the media today just highlighting the latest figures that suggest that drug-related deaths have again increased, but there's been a significant decrease in hospital admissions. I'm just interested in your views on what that is telling us and how we need to respond.
Thank you, and thanks very much for the invite to come back today. So, I think when we had the suspected and confirmed drug deaths for the previous year, there was some anticipation and hope that that was the start of the reduction in drug-related deaths. But of course, then what we saw for the suspected figures for the full year last year is a potential rise. And obviously in the summer, we will have the confirmed figures through National Records of Scotland. So it's quite clear that we're still not getting things right. In terms of the hospital admission specifically, there has been a lot of good work in terms of out-of-hospital activity, I would say. So much more community response. There's been a lot of additional work with the ambulance service, with Police Scotland in terms of overdose response as well. I don't know the exact answer to the question, but I would surmise that there has been a lot more engagement in community, a community approach across the country that is potentially that. The flip side of that is also the concerns that people just don't seek help when they're experiencing issues. And we know that there are still major concerns around stigma and discrimination for people who experience drug problems actually accessing health services. So that's probably the two sides of the coin.
Just on the hospital admissions then, I mean, I'm not aware in our previous committee meetings, I'm not aware that that's been a specific issue that has been raised or highlighted or indeed sort of discussed. Is it, do you have any sort of views on what's behind that decrease? I think it's certainly reported as around 24%.
I mean, basically just what I've sort of explained, that I don't have a clear answer for it, to be honest, but more community work, but still a real resistance from people who experience drug problems to access the health service. And I think both of those things will have an impact. I don't think just because there's been a reduction in hospital admissions that is to be seen as a positive, because quite often what will happen is when people have experienced an overdose, if they have been taken to hospital by the ambulance service, often they won't end up being admitted because they will leave prior to admission. So they may well have been taken to hospital but not then admitted, because people don't like to stay within the hospital environment. So
okay, thanks very much, and I'm sure other members might want to probe on that a little more. I wonder if I can come to Justina Murray. In your submission, which was very comprehensive, you state that while it's welcome that families had the opportunity to influence and engage the development of approaches to tackling drug harm, they're not reporting the level of change on the ground that you would be expecting to see at this stage, and that there remains an implementation gap between policy and delivery, if you like. So how, just in your view, from your perspective, how do we start closing that gap or addressing this?
Yeah, I think the implementation gap is something we talk about quite a lot. In fact, I think when I was here last year, I was talking about it as well. And I do think in Scotland we have got quite a progressive approach to drug policy, and a lot of the things that we write down in legislation and policy and strategy, you know, we're writing down the right things. And then, as I put in my written evidence, it's just not feeling real for families on the ground. And I think part of that is that there is a lot of activity, but sometimes that just feels a little bit like busyness, you know. And I think I reflected in my written evidence how much more paper has been produced just talking about all of the things that we're doing and, you know, different plans and strategies and so on. And I think a lot of that is still very much behind the scenes. So if we look at some of the kind of flagship projects like the Safe Drug Consumption Facility, which we're supportive of, and drug checking projects also supportive of, you know, we're not those are not functioning yet in reality. So for families sitting there, they're not seeing anything on the ground with all of this work going on in the background. And I think a lot of what we do is we come back to Parliament, we talk about the government, but actually we need to be getting alongside people on the ground a lot more and just really exploring what is getting in the way for them in terms of implementation. There still is a postcode lottery, so even where we've had like good national initiatives like the medication assisted treatment or MAT standards, it very much depends where you are in the country as to how well those are being implemented. And from my own team this week, I got kind of good and bad examples of that. So, you know, we don't truly understand why things are not being delivered on the ground as much as they should be. I don't think it's all about resources, to be honest, because a lot of extra resource has been released into the system. I think some of it is back to culture and attitudes. You know, Kirsten talked about stigma. And just the system, I mean, you were asking about hospital admissions, but we shouldn't see that as a separate thing than everything else that's going on. And we just need to redesign the whole system together, I think.
Thank you a lot in there. And that brings me neatly on to my next question for Dr. Fletcher, and that's around sort of whole system approach. And again, looking at your submission on behalf of the Dundee ADP, it sets out the work being undertaken to drive that whole system approach, but there is scope to further improve the approach and identify what you describe as the highest priorities for upstream interventions to prevent drugs deaths and wider drug harm. So I'm very interested in what you're looking at within that. Be interested in just hearing a wee bit more about that.
Yes, thank you. I mean, a whole system approach is absolutely imperative. Mm. I think it's been very clearly reflected in across national and local discussions that this is not one agency, organisation or approach to solve. It is all of us working together with a shared focus and priorities. The Alcohol and Drugs Partnership is an excellent forum for everyone, all key partners, to be in that room working towards the same priorities, the same aspirations. And I think we do that very well in Dundee and increasingly so over recent years. In terms, though, of where there are opportunities further, and it's really building on the work of the MAT standards. The MAT standards have been very helpful in really driving action, but particularly around opioid and substance use. Mm-hmm. I think there is, for me as an ADP chair, my colleagues, consideration as to those upstream interventions, and I'm thinking about housing, I'm thinking about employment, mm-hmm. I'm thinking about poverty. We invest in the local community planning partnerships and devolve and enable areas across Dundee to take a grassroots approach and work with the communities to support people with substance use. But I think in a time of increasing financial challenge, it would be really helpful to think about and have greater evidence about where we can best direct the limited resources that we have for greatest impact. And I think particularly coming from a medical background, we have a huge amount of research and evidence around, for example, cancer treatment, cancer care, what makes the biggest impact, but actually a real paucity of understanding where the greatest impacts can be in those upstream interventions for people, friends, families affected by substance use.
Yeah, thank you. And I noticed also in your submission that just on that, in terms of issues like housing, employment, you outlined that the vast majority of people who are affected by drug death experience multiple severe disadvantage. So perhaps there is more work required to address that whole, as a single approach.
I think that would be incredibly helpful. I think, and my colleagues beside me will be able to give examples as well in terms of how elements of the system that we work in are just not quite as responsive and supportive for people that are finding themselves in real difficulties.
Okay, thank you all. Okay, I'm going to bring in other members, and I'm going to come to Pauline McNeill and then Russell Emily. Pauline.
Thank you. Good morning. I was interested in the statistics around male deaths, which seems to be one of the very large problems. I just wonder if any work has been done to try and understand why that is, or can you help me understand why there's a prevalence amongst men and drug deaths? Yes, how are you?
Yeah, so we're seeing a very changing pattern, actually, with regards to drug deaths and how they affect men and women. For many years, we had predominantly seen drug deaths impacting men on a ratio of about 3-1. That has changed substantially over the past 5 years. So, for example, in Dundee in 2018, there were 47 deaths impacting men and 19 deaths impacting women. In 2022, that is the 47 deaths in men decreased to 18. The deaths in women, both very sadly, were constant. So it's 19 to 20. So the reduction that we are seeing locally has been due to a reduction in drug deaths impacting men, but we are seeing very little change for women, and we really want to understand that much, much more. We're taking a gendered approach, doing further analysis. We're working with colleagues through Protecting People, but it's a real changing dynamic that we're seeing over the past 5 years, and again, it's really important that we take that whole family person-centred approach to understand and really provide the support that each individual person needs.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to answer that, Kirsten?
Yeah, maybe just say on a national level, yes, absolutely still males that are more likely to die. More males use drugs as well, so the population of males is larger who use, and there are specific risk factors for both groups, but males more likely to experience homelessness, more likely to be rough sleeping, more likely to be using on their own. But there is definitely, I would agree with Emma, a gap in terms of specific service provision for women and the specific needs of women.
Yeah, I was interested in the 2022 figure, because it says men were twice as likely to have drug misuse deaths. So that's only 2 years ago. So Dr. Fletcher, I didn't understand fully what you were saying about the changing pattern then over the last 5 years, because in 2022, men were twice as likely to have a drug misuse death.
I'm very sorry, can you...
So in my note, I've got, in 2022, males were twice as likely to have a drug misuse death as females. Most of the decrease in the past year was in males. But I thought you'd said that there was a changing pattern between men and women.
Yes.
But it's only 2 years ago that men were twice as likely to have...
I'm happy to jump in here. So I think you were talking also about Dundee statistics versus national statistics.
But right.
Nationally, 4 or 5 years ago... nationally, 20 years ago, men were 4 or 5 times more likely than women to die, whereas now it's twice as likely. So women's deaths are reducing slower than men's deaths. So over the last year, men's deaths fell by 26% and women's by 10%. And I think, just as Kirsten's saying, we'd need very different approaches for women. So the Simon community have reflected that for the Glasgow Safe Drug Consumption Facility, which they are also supportive of along with us, men are much more likely to use that facility than women. So we need to think, well, what's the alternative provision for women, such as high tolerance housing and other kind of support? So I think maybe that's the confusion, Dundee versus national trends.
Right, no, that's really helpful. And I noted what Kirsten Horsbury had to say about men were more likely to be homeless and all the sort of factors that might lead them to be vulnerable to drug death. Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Russell Finlay, then Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. It's a quick first question for Dr. Fletcher. Now, the drugs consumption facility in Glasgow is coming. Edinburgh appears to be next. Does Tayside have any plans for one?
So it's something that we're very interested in and follow very closely. It'll be useful to see the evaluation from Glasgow, and that will help guide how we approach and potentially adopt it in future. I think it's also important to notice or note that we have a more poly substance use picture in Dundee, and that also impacts in terms of what is an optimal approach. So we are very focused on that multi-agency outreach and person-centred family approach. That is responsive to a polysubstance picture, but absolutely, we are interested in what is happening with Glasgow and then Edinburgh.
So, if it gets up and running in Glasgow in summer, as we're told it might, how long do you think you would need to see it in operation for before you could make an assessment?
Again, it'd be really helpful to see the evaluation from it, because that will guide how we could implement it to best effect. So that's what we're really looking for.
Roughly what kind of time scale do you think would be, you know, useful data? Is it a year or is it 6 months?
It depends entirely how that is implemented, the feedback from it, what is happening nationally in terms of, is there an expansion with MAT standards, all the priorities that we're seeking to address.
I mean, one thing that in one of the submissions from Dr. Murray's organisation, they're described as safe consumption facilities. I mean, do you accept that there's no such thing as a safe consumption facility, given the substances that are being taken? It's, the correct word is safer. I mean, that's for anyone, I suppose.
Coming in here and just to maybe reflect on some of the comments Emma's just made as well. I mean, the Glasgow service is called a safer drug consumption facility. It's, you know, they have all sorts of different names, but yes, it's safe for drug use because you've obviously got people there who can support people with any emergency or incident that occurs. My concern is about areas stalling on introducing facilities to await an evaluation procedure in Glasgow, because we're not trailblazers here in terms of introducing these facilities. These have been available since the 80s globally, and I think if we had a true approach in terms of introducing these types of facilities across this country where they're needed, wherever there is places where people are injecting and street-based injecting, we would have a variety of different models of them all operating at the same time, some peer-led, some static ones, some NHS-led, some mobile. And to really evaluate. Yeah,
presumably these could be tailored to local specific circumstances, as Dr. Fletcher described.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm happy to come in as well. I think this is one of the challenges for Scotland when all of our communities are so different, and we see the sort of investment, you know, government investment in big flagship projects, which tend to be in cities, you know, often Glasgow, where there's this very high level of need. And someone had reflected to me that, oh, but if they solve the Glasgow drug death problem, they solve Scotland's drug death problem, which I think is like statistically has some accuracy to it. But I don't know how that feels for if you're a family member in like Dumfries and Galloway or the Highlands or whatever. It's like, where is your equivalent response? And it's not necessarily going to be the Glasgow model, because that was first proposed actually around health risks of street injecting, not around drug-related deaths specifically. So that's not going to be the model that's going to work in a lot of other areas. But they should get, you know, an equivalent investment to develop local responses. And I don't know if we always see that investment following through.
Okay, I think Dr. Fletcher wants to go on.
Yeah, no, that would be helpful, to, thank you. I think the other thing to note about Safer Consumption Room is it is one element of an approach. And again, we've really got to be so alert and cognizant as to how we spend the very limited resources available to us to greatest impact. That is why I have an element of caution about that. And that's not saying that we don't absolutely advance work in other areas to support the person impacted, the family impacted, look at prevention, work in prevention, reducing stigma, all the other elements that are so important and indeed are reflected in some of the evidence around Safer Consumption Room. It is about that holistic care provided to the person in addition to providing that facility.
Yeah. I'd like to just come in on the issue of synthetic opioids. Now, 15 of these have just been assigned Class A substances, and they've been featured in a significant and growing number of deaths in Scotland, as they have done worldwide. And I just wonder if, between the expertise that you all have and different kind of perspectives, how prevalent they are becoming and what the sort of specific concerns are about them to people who might not really understand the difference between our traditional opioids and, say, the synthetic stuff that we hear about. So I don't know if anyone would come in first.
Thank you. I mean, it goes back to the whole problem that people just don't know what they're taking overall, because we don't have widespread drug checking facilities for people to be able to test what's in their substances. So we already have a significant issue in terms of our drug deaths crisis. The introduction of synthetic opioids like nitazenes is a major concern, because of the potency of them and because people just don't know. So they would be using their supply that they normally have, and then all of a sudden it could potentially contain much more powerful opiates. So it's not hugely prevalent at the moment. The truth is we don't know, but we would know if it was very prevalent, because people would be overdosing in even higher numbers than they are currently. We've started some small pilot projects of supplying people with nitazene test strips so that they can actually test their own substances to see. And actually yesterday we had our first positive test from one of those test strips in one of the areas. So using that as a bit of a tool to try and get a little bit of information.
If an individual uses one of these and it comes up positive, is your advice, or would that make them not take it, or just know what they're dealing with, or what's the thinking behind that?
Yeah, so it's an interesting tool to use as engagement with people, because, I mean, yes, there's the one part that is you can potentially identify whether a substance is positive or not for nitazenes, but actually it really helps you to open up that conversation with somebody about concerns around risks, new substances, in terms of reducing that risk of their drug use. When we've been training people in the living experience groups that we've been supplying these test strips to, they've had a variety of responses. So the staff that have been delivering them have asked the question, what would you do if you got a positive result? Some people have said they wouldn't use it. Some people have said they would still use it, but they would use less. And some people have said that they would carry on the same. But, you know, it's about having those conversations with people. And we're also asking people to send those samples on to the Welsh service Wedanos for confirmatory testing, because we know that there's some concern around the accuracy of the test strips. So
You said something earlier about you've not seen a significant rise, thankfully, in touch wood, but is it almost you're anticipating the likelihood of that?
Yeah, absolutely. If we are to see a large introduction of nitazenes into the drug supply, we will absolutely see an increased number of drug-related deaths, and we are not equipped to be dealing with it. We're not equipped for dealing with the current emergency situation that we're faced. So to have this on top of that is like an additional element to the crisis that we already have.
And I don't know if the other witnesses would like to come in on that.
Move things on and we can come back if we've got time.
Thank you.
So I'm going to bring in Paul Sweeney and then Claire Hawley.
Thank you, Convener. Ms Horsburgh, you just mentioned that Scotland is by far not a leading proponent of introduction of safer overdose prevention facilities. Just wondered whether you had a view on the pace and the process of the development of the official safer drug consumption pilot facility in Glasgow.
I'm a member of the implementation board and the workforce subgroup of the Glasgow facility, and actually was involved in some of the interviews for the key staff the other day, so it's an exciting bit of progress. I think they're going as fast as they can in terms of implementation. Obviously, work has started on the build work of the facility, and it's still at the expected timescale that it will be open towards the end of summer. I don't think they could move it any faster than they are currently, but obviously it's been almost 8 years since the proposal was put in the first place, so that part of the progress has been absolutely far too slow. The concern that we now have is the progress going to be even slower for introducing these sorts of facilities across the rest of the country?
Is the model adopted in Glasgow for the OPC or Safer Drug Consumption Facility match what you would have liked to have seen in an ideal world based on international benchmarks? Could it benefit from further development?
Yeah, absolutely, because obviously part of it is there are some restrictions in terms of what the Lord Advocate has allowed for this facility to be introduced. So it has to be an integrated service with attachment to other healthcare. So there are some restrictions around what they've been able to do with this service. Obviously, the major red flag for it is that they won't have an inhalation component to the facility, when we know that there's a lot of people smoking crack cocaine and also smoking heroin that would benefit from that being part of the facility too. So I would hope that that would be introduced as well. I don't think there's any issues with the model. The model has worked well in other countries in terms of having that sort of medical approach, but it's not the only approach. So hence why I was saying it would be good to have other types of facilities that might suit different needs for different people who would access them. And it would also have helped to have had more running at the same time, to have taken that real tension off the one particular service and that real sort of media and political focus off the one service. So it would be good to introduce others at pace.
One thing I did notice when I visited the Copenhagen facilities was that there was a part of a cluster within the district of rehabilitation facilities, drug checking facilities were available on site. There was also a lot of pastoral support, social work, housing. There was even a drug users union within the community, and it seemed to be overall a very good self-reinforcing ecosystem that really had massively reduced drug-related criminality, but also had achieved great public health outcomes. Do you think there is significant opportunity to develop along those kind of models within the wider community?
Yeah, absolutely. And like others have said, like the actual consumption facility itself is not the only answer. And it's all those wraparound things that make the success. So yeah, all the things that you've just mentioned. Plus, I would like to see us move to a model of high tolerance housing that's been mentioned as well. So you've got a situation in the Netherlands where they've had these facilities for many, many years, and they've actually started to close some of them down because people have moved to much more of a high tolerance acceptance that people use within the residential facilities. But yeah, that whole wraparound description that you just gave would be absolutely welcome in Scotland too.
Dr. Fletcher, I know you're nodding there. Is this something you're looking at closely in terms of emulating and hopefully benefiting from the learning curves that Glasgow is sort of leading on?
Absolutely, and as Kirsten has described, it is that holistic wraparound support that is so incredibly invaluable. Yes.
That's great. And
yeah, I'd like to add, if you don't mind, that I think it's maybe a good example of the fact that in Scotland we applaud ourselves for our public health approach to drugs. But actually, I think in reality, we've kind of interpreted that as a health and then a health service approach, and so much of the investment in tackling drug harms in Scotland is into NHS services. It's not really a public health investment, which is about families, communities, you know, whole populations. To, just as you're saying, these kind of wraparound initiatives around poverty, homelessness, you know, relationships, all of those other issues. And it does seem that, again, this is going to be quite a clinical model. Clinical models do work, you know, as Kirsten said, they are evident elsewhere. But I don't think we're really living up to that public health banner that we champion so much in Scotland.
Are there any examples around the world that you've seen that might be something we should look more closely at emulating?
Well, I'm going to give a really bad example, actually, because it's a health service example. But I was at an event the other day where someone was talking from Australia about a model they had within a hospital where they had developed a dedicated ward for people who were admitted under the influence of drugs or alcohol. But on that ward, where they had 6 beds, yes, they had clinicians, but also they had social workers, peer workers, you know, people dealing with, you know, poverty and debt issues, housing and homelessness. And actually they were providing, in an NHS setting, this kind of wraparound service. It was a multidisciplinary team. And I had never heard of anything like that in Scotland, apparently. You know, it is now being looked at. I'm not sure where. So that's a really bad example when I just said everything shouldn't be within the NHS. But I think it shows it can be done. But I'm not aware it is being done in Scotland just now.
Okay, thank you. Before I bring in Claire Hawhey, Pauline McNeill, I think you maybe wanted to...
Yeah, it's just a supplementary. I do agree it is an exciting and important step to take to see what contribution safer consumption rooms can make. As a Glasgow member, I just wondered, so obviously I'm familiar with where the pilot's going to take place in Glasgow. Has there been any feedback from the local community about, because it strikes me it's really got to have the support of the local community, because if they don't feel safe where this is located, then it could be a setback. I just wondered if you could tell the committee anything about what engagement there's been with the local community. I mean, one thing that's been fed to me by the local councillor there is that there is some concern, and they think the location isn't great for public transport. So that was one of the things that I'm aware of.
Yep, thank you. So you've got obviously somebody on panel two that will be able to speak in more detail about that. But certainly they have been doing a lot of community engagement. And you're right that there is a lot of tension there as well. But everywhere in the world that has introduced these types of facilities have had this experience with the local community initially. I don't think you'll ever be able to win over hearts and minds for introducing a facility like this until it's actually up and running and people can see with their own eyes the difference that it makes. But I think it's so important for the team in Glasgow to be engaging with the community, with the neighbourhood, with the businesses, which they are doing, and to keep them up to date with the progress of the facility once the facility is operating. Being able to actually have a look in the facility to see what it's like. Sydney was a good example of that, they used to have open mornings when people were obviously not in there injecting, to have a look to see what it actually is, to dispel a lot of the myths around it. But they'll need to have a really responsive approach. So this facility is not going to immediately reduce all the discarded injecting equipment in the area. But, for instance, if the community has a contact person within the service and they'll be able to really be proactive in terms of their approach to respond to any concerns as the facility develops, that will help with the local relationships. So they're doing everything that they can, but it's inevitable that there will be concerns until it's actually up and running.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. OK, Claire Hawhey, followed by Paula Keane.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. And before I start, I'll refer members to my register of interest. I hold a bank nurse contract with Greater Glasgow and Clyde NHS, and I actually recently worked in an ADRS service on a bank shift. Much of what I was going to ask Russell Finlay is already covered, but we've known about synthetic opioids for some time. And Public Health Scotland published a radar alert in January 23. That was updated in December last year, and Dundee Alcohol and Drug Partnership noted in their submission an increased risk associated with emergent synthetic opioids. So what more do we need to do to tackle this, to get ahead of that threat, that danger that there is coming towards us?
I wonder if I should come in, but given that you're citing Dundee ADP evidence. I think what I would like to reflect is that we work in a dynamic picture. The substances that people take do change, and they have changed quite markedly over the past 5-10 years. Particularly in the past 5 years, we've seen new psychoactive substances, we've seen the threat of fentanyl, we've seen increased use of cocaine, benzodiazepine, gabapentinoids, and now nitazenes. And we absolutely are right to be alert to this. Kirsten mentioned drug checking, and that will absolutely help in future. What we do locally is through our public health function, monitor trends closely. So both the suspected drug death notifications that we receive in from Police Scotland, albeit please note that there is a significant time lag with the post-mortem and toxicology results at the moment, and that is of considerable concern and challenge to us. But we also monitor the near-fatal overdoses, and we meet on a daily basis to discuss any notification of a near-fatal overdose. And whilst we might not be able to understand or know immediately what the underlying driver is, that as soon as we see, or we can monitor that from any clustering or increasing incidents, we will convene what's called a problem assessment group or an incident management team under the public health structure. That's for risk assessment, risk management, risk communication. And we will use that to build up a much clearer, kind of combined, that's a multi-agency forum, understanding of what is happening. Understand if there are any concerns, be it through local intelligence, through what people are reporting, the environment, if there's any anecdotal reports. It's very difficult to get that confirmation of the substance at the moment, but it will trigger increased communications, alert to health, social care providers, education, and we will take a much more intensive harm reduction approach as required. So I think it's about being vigilant. It's about that collaborative working. It's about that forum where people feel enabled to raise concerns, for us to collectively understand what is happening and to outreach and support in the communities as impacted, and work closely with all agencies and organisations. I think that's what I would be advocating, and that's certainly what the approach that we're taking locally in regards to preparations for any emerging trends, nitazenes being one of them.
Okay. And in terms of, that's all well and good in terms of the agencies, but in terms of families and those who are using the substances, what sort of education outreach is there to equip them with that information about what's emerging, what the dangers are of those particular substances?
So that's through the range of services that support people, whether it's through the specialist drug and alcohol recovery services, whether it's through third sector organisations, whether it's through the specialist harm reduction services that we have, whether it's through education in schools, whether it's policing the community. It's using the forum in which we work to share the understanding of what's happening, to support colleagues, to upskill in knowledge about emerging trends, and to be able to engage with people to have those conversations and to provide support. But broadly, the harm reduction approaches are common to all drug taking, but it's to make sure that they're alert and aware of potential emerging trends.
So that's I'll come back to you in a second, Kirsten, because you might be able to wrap both of these particular issues up. So that takes me on then to, as you mentioned there, Dr. Fletcher, harm reduction and the use of naloxone. And so we've seen a decrease in the use of emergency naloxone, and I'm keen to hear from the panel about how you interpret that. You know, is it a sign it's not needed as much, or does it indicate that people aren't using it, or it's not needed, or people don't see that they need it, or they're not being able to access it. So if I maybe come to you, Kirsten, if you can maybe wrap both of those answers.
No problem, thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to add on to the bit about what we should be providing for people who use drugs, and I mentioned about the nitazene test strips, but it goes to this. you know, we can produce as many alerts as we want about new drugs, but actually being able to provide something with somebody with something physical, so whether they can test their drugs or whether it's a naloxone supply, says with actions much better than words that we care about you and we care about whether you live or die, and it really helps impart that message about risk. So the actual provision of these things is important. So we don't have, for instance, inhalation devices for people who are smoking crack cocaine. So a lot of our services are not equipped to actually provide people with the equipment that they need so they can provide alerts, but it's the actions that are more meaningful. Naloxone's a really good thing to mention here, because naloxone does work on synthetic opioids, so we are encouraging people to carry more than one kit with them. So increasing the supply of naloxone is important. The figures that you're quoting there, I'm imagining, are from the ambulance service, so a reduction in administrations through the ambulance service maybe hints towards more use by lay people, which is not collected as cohesively in terms of the data. So we have obviously police administered naloxone. We have members of the public, community members, people who use drugs, families, all administering naloxone, and those figures are not collected as routinely as they are with the ambulance service. So I would imagine that that could potentially add to that.
I'm going to give some evidence about our click and deliver naloxone service. So since that was established in May 2020, we've issued almost 16,000 naloxone kits across Scotland. Those are used by a wide variety of people, you know, people at risk of overdose themselves, families, professionals, and also members of the public. And just looking at the latest statistics, we issued pretty much the same number of kits in the last financial year and the year before, just over 5,000. And in the last financial year, 36% of those went to members of the public. So it's really a fantastic development, you know, that people are happy to carry naloxone. They realise that they've got that potential to save a life, just as any other sort of first aid intervention. If I could also comment, though, about the synthetic opioids issue, I think there's always a risk it becomes a kind of new shiny thing that distracts from what we should already be doing. And I'm, you know, really reinforcing what Kirsten's saying here. We shouldn't really be doing too much that's different than what we should be already doing around harm reduction. And I'm slightly anxious that there's going to be an overemphasis on the impact of synthetic opioids when this year's drug-related death statistics come out. And if we think that, you know, almost 10,000 people have died through drugs in Scotland over the past decade, that's before synthetic opioids were really around. So, you know, we know that we should be doing all of these harm reduction measures anyway. We know that synthetics are right through the supply. Families often don't know what their loved ones are taking anyway. And even if people don't know themselves what they're taking, families are definitely not going to know. So we're pushing out the information we can, but we really need to double down on the harm reduction measures instead of this sort of slightly glacial pace of change that we're experiencing just now.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if, just before I bring in our next member, if I can just pick up on the points that you were making, Dr. Fletcher, about feedback on toxicology, just because of the sort of issues that we're facing at the moment around the timescales for postmortems. I'm quite interested in just, you did articulate that in some detail, but what are we looking at in terms of timescales? Is it weeks? Is it longer?
So my understanding is it's months, but I would need to check with my colleagues what the current state is. But it's certainly impeding both our intelligence and understanding of the underlying causes from a substance perspective, and also it's impacting the families affected, and that's really sad and devastating to see also.
I'm not an expert in toxicology, but are there options available that perhaps can provide some sort of early feedback over and above, you know, while we're waiting for the sort of more the fuller toxicology work to be done? Is there something that can be provided by way of an early indication?
my understanding is the only kind of early indication is through what people have reported that the person mm-hmm. has understood that they've taken, but that often doesn't actually replicate what is in the substance themselves. Mm-hmm. And also, I think, and again, my colleagues either side might know more about this, but the toxicology is a national contract, mm-hmm. and therefore there's very little that we can do and it's through the Crime Procurator Fiscal Service, mm-hmm. is my understanding. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing that we can do to impact or mm-hmm. get an earlier understanding.
Yeah, Kirsten, I don't know. Do you want to come in on that, Kirsten, or just, you know?
I think it's just an example of how much the system is focused on people who've died and overdose situations, and actually, what about everybody else? So we know that we could be doing a whole lot more when people are still alive around improving their quality of life, reducing harm, but we're kind of... The system is, you know, even the number of meetings and the amount of effort and funding that goes into responding to overdose and death. Like, let's wait till someone's died and then we'll find out, you know, what they were taking. I understand there's a small project in Glasgow which does test after someone's had a non-fatal overdose, but that's, again, a sort of academic, if you like, and mm-hmm. those results are not shared with the individual or their family. It's just to find out, you know, what's happening mm-hmm. in the drugs market, if you like. So we know already people are using really toxic combinations of drugs. We don't need toxicology reports to tell us that. Mm-hmm. And it just feels, again, it's that bit of the system that's focused on after the fact, as opposed to everything which should be about prevention and early intervention, which, again, through that public health approach, we talk about doing all of the time.
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting, Justina. And I would say that I am aware that there is work underway to address a sort of wider challenge with access to pathology services in Scotland. So that's something that we'll be looking at closely. So thanks for that. So I'm going to bring in Paul O'Kane and then Rose McCall.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I think this committee has been interested in the progress of the MAT standards and have thought to scrutinise and track those, I suppose. And we know that the most recent benchmarking data we have from Public Health Scotland has found patchy implementation, I think it's fair to say, and we've seen slippage in terms of the timescales for full delivery in community and justice settings, 66% of standards 1 to 5 being fully implemented, and obviously 88% of 6 to 10 standards being partially implemented. So I think we're keen to get a sense of where those barriers are. We've seen in written submissions, obviously, some of the challenges around, I think, a postcode lottery being described, and also some of the infrastructure not being in place. So I wonder if Dr. Fletcher might first want to reflect on progress and your views as to the barriers of full implementation.
Yeah, thank you. I would start by saying that the MAT standards have been very helpful in driving change. And I think we in Dundee have made considerable progress and have recently just submitted our evidence for the latest benchmarking and have received encouraging informal feedback to which has been welcome. There are limitations with the MAT standards. They are very opioid focused. And as I've described, we work in an environment that's polysubstance use. And I think these are my reflections in terms of work going forward. My understanding is that there is looking to broaden the MAT standards out, and that would be very welcome, but we would be very keen to be part of those discussions as to how nationally how we can influence and drive them forward to greatest benefit and impact. I think also what has been welcome with the MAT standards is the resource that has been attached, and that has been helpful. When you think about how we spend our public sector pound, and particularly within health, relatively, drugs and alcohol, supporting people with drugs and alcohol is relatively under-resourced compared to other health conditions. And I think we have a degree of apprehension going forward in terms of should the resource that's been allocated to support the implementation of MAT not be continued, then that would pose considerable risk in a number of areas. But broadly, the MAT standards have been helpful in driving forward change locally.
just on that point that we heard about, I suppose, infrastructure being in place, I mean, is your concern now that we've made progress in terms of the infrastructure, but it's perhaps ongoing resourcing that might become the more substantive issue?
Absolutely. So we have a number of fixed term posts and work that have been that we've been able to take forward as a result of MAT funding. And if we were not to have confirmation of that going forward, then that would pose significant risk to the continuity of being able to continue to deliver that.
Okay. I wonder if Kirsten might want to.
Yeah, sure. Thanks very much. I agree that undoubtedly there has been significant change in the way services are provided because of the MAT standards. However, they are far from perfect, our service provision, and they're also missing the boat when it comes to people's change in drug use. So Emma mentioned there about the opioid focus. So we hear from a lot of people that actually they're not attending services because, yes, they're using opiates, but they're also using crack cocaine, benzos, gabapentinoids, and everything else, and they know that those needs won't be met, so they don't see the point in attending treatment services to have one small part of their drug use looked at, whereas the whole picture is not being addressed. So we definitely need to look at our prescribing services in terms of what's on offer for people. There's very limited benzodiazepine prescribing. There's absolutely no pharmaceutical equivalent being provided for cocaine use, which is becoming extremely problematic and has also contributed to many, many more deaths over the last years. All of that needs addressed. We also have a sort of static population in terms of the numbers of people experiencing problem drug use from recent research that's been done. But what that has really heavily indicated is that whilst the numbers of people haven't risen in terms of numbers of people experiencing problem drug use, the risk factors for this population absolutely have. So we're just not meeting the needs in the way that we should be. Treatment is absolutely a protective factor. So that's also been highlighted through recent research again, because we always have to repeat this message that treatment is protected, but not without the whole wraparound interventions that are required as well.
And would you recognise that there is a significant challenge in those additional services that are, I suppose, tangential to the work of delivering MAT standards? So in terms of like social work and advice and rights and all the support that sits around it, because I think from what I'm taking from your answer is it's that holistic look that needs to happen in terms of this delivery.
Yeah, absolutely. And much better education for people about what their options are before they even approach a treatment service. So this is where we're getting to some issues with same-day prescribing. Same-day does not mean you approach a service one day and on that same day you get an appointment for a week's time. Like, same-day means you approach the service knowing what it is that you want and you're able to be provided with that on the day that you appear. But because a lot of people are attending the service, we're hearing from services that they are then explaining the choices to people, and then that's taken time. And so we need to get better at that sort of whole systems approach about making sure that people know what's available to them and what they can access, so that the same day stuff is working a bit better. But yeah, there are still major issues in terms of the implementation. The other thing that we heard recently was that areas are saying that they feel like they have met the needs of everybody in their area that is experiencing opiate use, and we're hearing something very different from people who use drugs in those localities for those reasons I mentioned about not feeling like the services are going to meet their needs.
And do you think, just in terms of measurement, there has to be a better way to capture that lived experience and that, you know, what those people are telling you essentially?
Yeah, I think there's been some really good examples of that. The experiential data that's collected as part of the MAT standards work, we've been involved in some of that through Scottish Drugs Forum. We've done an observational study with participants over a 6-month period, and we've also supported some of the ADPs with their experiential work. And that, you have to have that real reality from people to be able to improve your service. And it's difficult to hear, and it's difficult to hear the things that aren't going well, but unless we are getting to the truth of what's happening for people, nothing's ever going to change.
Justina?
Yeah, I mean, it has been great to hear about people really using the MAT standards, so like individuals and family members going into services kind of brandishing the MAT standards and, you know, claiming their rights. That's been very positive. And I think also it's given permission to staff to work in a different way. So when I'd asked my team for some examples earlier on this week, One of them shared an example of Matt Standard 3 about the Assertive Outreach, where a woman had gone missing. It was looking very grim, actually, but through the partnership working between the family and the family support and the treatment service, there was that real assertive outreach, and they located the woman. They were able to kind of keep her safe and also link her back in to treatment. So that kind of permission to work in a certain way, I think, has been very positive. I think the less positive side is, like, what do you do if the standards aren't upheld? And we don't really want people to be having to go through, like, formal complaints processes and legal challenges and so on. So I think that side of things definitely needs to be improved. But yeah, just otherwise, just support what the others have said about work in progress.
Yeah, and just in terms of, I suppose, the third sector's engagement and as a valued partner, I mean, do you feel that that is working well in terms of the service has been able to have a parity of esteem and you know, those important professional conversations are happening?
I think third sector definitely isn't in that place of parity of esteem. But there, again, it's patchy in terms of postcode, but there's definitely been more opportunity, I think, to work alongside treatment services. And I suppose the examples I've got have depended on families connecting with family support to connect in with the MAT standards. And I'm not so cited on how much families have been able to kind of link in without that facilitation of family support services.
Okay. And if I can just...
Can I come back to you?
Yeah, of course.
There's time at the end.
Thank you, convener.
Because
yeah.
I've still got a few members still to come in. So I'm going to bring in Rose McCall and then Sandish Gilhani. Rose.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everyone. Thank you very much indeed. It's been very interesting so far. Earlier on, there was some comments regarding stigma and the issues that stigma is having, especially when it comes to people actually moving forward and seeking the support that's already there, as you've already mentioned. Now, of course, there's the National Stigma Action Plan was one of the recommendations, and a rapid implementation of that was what was requested. The two words there for me are rapid and action. So I'm really interested in, especially with the early submissions, just how that's going. So can I basically start from one side and work the way down? What I'm really interested to know is, what are your views on the progress on the action plan so far? How effective has that action been, and is it working? What more do you think has to be done? And would you say it was rapid? Put you on the spot first, Kirsten, if that's
thanks.
Okay.
Okay, so firstly, I would say that I think the work of the National Collaborative has been excellent in terms of getting together a change team to produce a charter of rights. And that has obviously included people with lived living experience, family members and others, and been a very inclusive process. And I must admit that I am slightly confused about how the Stigma Action Plan fits with that piece of work. So no, I don't think it's been rapid, and no, I don't think there's been much implementation around a Stigma Action Plan as yet. And I am unclear still, even though it's been presented to me, so maybe it's just me, about the links between the Stigma Action Plan, the Collaborative, all the other groups that we start to see being developed. So there's also a group on women and substance use that's also looking at stigma. It feels disconnected, and the concern with the disconnect is that there won't be any clout to it as well. That's probably as much as I have to...
That's brilliant. Thank you. I do like a short, succinct answer, especially when I get four questions in a one. Emma, if I could ask you to come in, please.
Yes, I think stigma is incredibly challenging, and my reflection is about what drives it, why it arises. It's a lack of compassion, lack of understanding. It's ignorance, and it's underconfidence. And I think whilst within an alcohol and drugs partnership, people are very alert to the impact of stigma and can help be leaders across the area and the locality in terms of how stigma should be tackled. We ran locally a Language Matters campaign to raise awareness, and as I've described as well, it's been a focus of our work through the local community planning partnerships. But it's also about how we provide staff and people who work and support families, people impacted by substance use, to have the confidence to be able to engage in those discussions and be able to signpost for advice. And I think a focus of our work going forward is how that expands much more widely outside the Alcohol and Drug Partnership.
Okay, thank you. And can I just ask, the information coming from the Scottish Government, obviously it's their action plan that they're trying to put forward, is that meeting what you're doing? Is that dovetailing properly, or is it just not hitting the mark?
It's something that we're cognizant and we build into our delivery framework.
Okay, thank you. Last but no means least.
I think it would be a bit of a stretch to say it's been rapid and there's been too much action, but I think what is positive is in the new Stigma Action Plan, they are talking about some kind of accredited scheme for services. At the time of the Drug Death Task Force, a stigma charter was proposed, and families said at the time, well, how's that going to work? Like, if you go into a service and they're actually being quite discriminatory and disparaging and they've got the stigma charter posted up, what do you do? And we were told it wasn't really about that, you know, it literally was around the optics, I think. So families kind of withdrew from that whole process. And okay. So I think it is more positive now that there is going to be a more robust sort of accreditation scheme that services can really work towards that. But I think one of the broader issues around stigma is the way that we just keep othering this issue of drug harm, and we act like we're talking about kind of somebody else. And I'm very conscious, you know, here today, there are people in this room, definitely in this building, who have experienced drug harms, either through their own use or someone else's use. And so it's our families, it's our friends, it's our colleagues, it's our communities. And yet the way we think about drugs, it's everywhere else. And I think that's the main way we can really tackle stigma, just to be more open about, you know, have more of a national conversation about what's happening with drugs in our families and our communities. And it's so hard to do that just now because there's such a, I reflect again, we're not really in that public health space. It's definitely that kind of criminal justice, you know, it's all individual behaviour and it's, you know, deviant. And that's really the way that drugs are seen in Scotland. And I don't think it's really helping tackle stigma.
So that's what, and the sort of question I ask is, what more can we do is to really just shine a light on that and start discussing it more?
Yeah, and I think to be a little bit cautious about some of the public campaigns as well. Like, I wasn't a fan of the previous campaign. I called it the Weeping Lady campaign. It was quite, you know, negative view of somebody using drugs or in recovery. And I think there's so many more positive views and positive images we could show of, you know, people using drugs safely and people in recovery. And we should be more generous with that kind of imagery rather than, you know, just it's all sad and weeping and just a very negative vibe, I think, of the last public advert around stigma.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you. Keith Sandesh Gahani, followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener. A declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. Dr. Fletcher, I believe it was you that said funding was not an issue at the start here. And
was it you?
Sorry, Justina. Yeah. So if I could put the question to you then, Justina. 2/3 of ADPs report insufficient funds to implementing MAT standards. 1/2 of ADPs report insufficient funds for residential rehab. Glasgow's HSCP has rehab cuts, significant rehab cuts, and services for children living with drug users. That's stark and very worrying for me.
My sense is that, you know, that resources have always been the go-to explanation for why things aren't implemented. And I think through the National Drugs Mission, there's been a release of £250 million of additional resource into the system. Most of that money, as I've said, has gone to NHS boards for NHS-led services. And I am never going to sit there as a charity CEO and say, you know, oh, there's loads and loads of money in the third sector and, you know, we feel sorry for the statutory sector. You know, we're the ones in the third sector that are very much living on the edge financially, and we're supposed to be working together in this system. And we can see in a lot of the NHS services, they're having issues recruiting staff, retaining staff. You know, sometimes doing things through an NHS route is maybe the most expensive way of doing things as well. And I just think, you know, we need to redesign and rebuild this whole system that we've been talking about. And I think, you know, I'm not confident that we don't have enough resource in the system. I just don't think it's all in the right place.
So more money going into the third sector would be a good way of doing that. something that I would firmly support. If I could turn to Dr. Fletcher, just with that stark outlook, how are we going to improve rehabilitation services?
So I have my doctor hat on when I answer this question, because I think within our health service, we are weighted towards funding health conditions that impact people living in least deprivation more. And that's through the research that we've conducted to date. That's through very strong evidence-based randomised controlled trials. The difficulty is, through a public health approach, being able to evidence the impact housing, education to that same degree. So we are in a position whereby we as a collective population, as a society, really need to think carefully about how we spend our money. For people, premature mortality in Tayside currently, so people who die before the age of 75, the number for people living in greatest deprivation is twice that in least deprivation. And the drivers of that are drugs, alcohol, mental health challenges. So, and yet I think if we were to look at our healthcare services spend across all health conditions, we will see it very, very starkly weighted to health conditions more experienced in areas of least deprivation. So there's a huge, huge question for us as a society and as a medical profession as to where we best direct our resource and how that's evidenced and how that evidence drives how we spend our money.
Of course, you are right with the new GP contract rewarding those in better off areas with more money going into there. But I do want to focus upon rehab. I went to visit Rainbow House in Glasgow. Peer support, volunteers, it's a residential rehab programme. And I got to speak to three peer support volunteers, and it was a fantastic experience. But they were very clear with what they wanted me to raise and what they wanted me to talk about. And that was ensuring that people who ask for help get it in the way that they are asking for it. They get it in a timely manner, and that peer support is the best way of getting through. And another example is an innovative Glasgow rehab that I went to visit, where it was award-winning, and the person who worked there as the only real employee, and he's a former user who now does community outreach and has actively seen a huge drop in people using drugs, but his funding's been cut. And Rainbow House is worried about their funding. So how can we get people to stop consuming drugs if we're not funding rehab?
So it reflects all the discussions I think we have had in the session to date about the importance, as you've described, of that holistic wraparound support. Recovery is a priority focus for us in Dundee Alcohol and Drugs Partnership, and it is something that we are continuing to progress. It comes back to what we've described in terms of housing, in terms of employment, in terms of that family approach. So it's all of this action that we are collectively taking together to make that difference for the people impacted on our communities. And
Do you mind if I just jump in there? Because I don't think Scotland's drug policy is to stop people using drugs. You know, I think we need to differentiate between drug use and drug harm. Lots of people use drugs, lots of people use alcohol in Scotland. It's really the harm is the bit that we need to get involved. And Scotland's drug policy is about reducing that harm and reducing drug deaths. So rehab is a fantastic option for people it works for. I think something like £100 million of the drugs mission has been put towards rehab. So there shouldn't be a shortage of money. Whether the funding is getting down to the rehabs, I suppose, is the different question. But it shouldn't be the only option. And I think sometimes we have this bias, sometimes an unconscious bias, towards thinking that abstinent recovery is what everybody needs to get to, as this kind of pinnacle. But actually, for some people, that's not their choice. It's not what they want. I think And I think that's actually damaging our implementation, because that is seen as the gold standard. And for a lot of people, it's not a reality.
Rehab is damaging.
I think it works if you want to become abstinent and the rehab model works for you, it works. And I think a lot of the big voices in Scottish drug policy have been people who've had very successful outcomes from being in rehab themselves. So I think it works for you if it works for you and that's what you want. But I don't think we can have our whole policy wired towards abstinent recovery, because actually that's not the reality for people. And I think we need to get more focused on reducing harm and being person-centred. Like, if somebody wants, for somebody, their recovery might be actually, it's more their quality of life, you know, being safe in their drug use and not being so at risk of overdose.
Okay, so my last question, convener. We do all talk about drug deaths, but illicit drug consumption has significant health harms. Even if you just take it once, you could have a significant health harm that occurs to you. And all the questions we've had from the panel so far has focused upon this, everything else apart from rehab, which is why I'm focusing upon rehab. And it's clear what I have been told by people. So if I can go back to Dr. Fletcher, do you think we should be spending more money on rehab given the amount of cuts that are coming from the Glasgow HSCP and ADPs saying that half reporting insufficient funds for residential rehab?
So I'll refer to my previous answer in terms of how we consider and resource across the health system and the public sector to support people living in greatest deprivation. I think it is an area that of huge challenges. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here today. And all elements are important, and rehab is part of that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Colette Stevenson.
Very good morning to you all, and apologies for being late this morning. I would like to touch upon the drug checking pilot projects that have been rolled out in each of your areas. I understand it's Glasgow, Dundee and Aberdeen as well. So I'll bring in Dr Emma Fletcher, if you could maybe provide an update on the introduction of the drug checking pilot projects and any particular issues, problems that you've found or you've encountered?
Yeah, so the drug checking pilot in Dundee is being taken forward by one of our third sector partners in the partnership, Hillcrest, and supported by the Alcohol and Drugs Partnership. I think it would be fair to say that it's been quite extensive and resource intensive in terms of doing all the applications, the preparatory work, a lot of considerations around the logistics that are quite complex. For example, just the mechanics of transporting a substance for testing. And so there's been a lot of that for the team to work through. They've been working closely with the other pilot sites to share learning and share kind of best solutions for advancing that. And the application went in at the end of last month.
Okay. When will you get the outcome of the application for the licence?
I don't know. That's out with my control, I'm afraid.
Okay, thank you. Can I maybe bring in Justina and Kirsten on that?
I don't have a lot to add. I mean, I know families are supportive of drug checking, and the Scottish Drug Checking Project found that people that would use a facility or service like that definitely supported like third sector delivery. That was the model that they wanted, some of the very accessible and non-stigmatising and so on. So really looking forward to seeing these develop.
And so just to add, a little bit similar to the drug consumption facility issue, in that just to have three static sites for drug check-in is not going to be enough for the whole of Scotland. So other countries that have developed this really well and significantly have had mobile testing devices. They're able to take them places. They can take them into services and do drop-ins for people. They can take them into people's homes. They can provide people with their own testing kits. So it's great to see it progressing. It's too slow and it's not enough.
I mean, just the practicalities of it and even trying to entice people to actually use these services, how have you found that as well?
So the, for our pilot, we're embedding it into a service that already provides harm reduction advice. So that was a purposeful choice so that we can offer drug check-in as part of the wider harm reduction in approach.
OK, thanks very much. Oh, do you want to come in, Kirsten? Sorry.
We've been providing the Wedinoffs bags to people attending our Living Experience Engagement Groups, which is the Welsh drug check-in service that accepts samples from anywhere in the UK. So we encourage participants in that forum to send off their own samples, and they are engaging in that really well. So there is a desire among people to actually know what's in their substances and to give people a bit more autonomy around their drug use, and that's been proven so far.
Okay. And in terms of, Justina, from a third sector point of view, is that available, the kits are available to most third sector organisations? Are you aware of that?
What, the drug testing kits?
Yeah.
No, I mean, the only developments in terms of the projects I've heard about are the three you mentioned, and obviously you've talked about nitazene strips. And I know Family Support Service in South Lanarkshire are now stocking the nitazene strips as well. Just now we are issuing the naloxone kits, and we haven't yet had a conversation about what to do next. But I'm very mindful of what you're saying about using it as an engagement tool, and just to have that conversation with people about, you know, we care about your well-being, and here's something that could help.
Okay, no, that's really helpful. Thanks you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Are you wanting to come in with a supplementary? And then I'll bring Paul O'Kane back in.
Thank you, Convener. Just a quick one on Wedinoffs. Obviously, it's a great service, but it's a correspondence service, effectively. Is there an opportunity with the overdose prevention pilot in Glasgow to set up a co-located facility that could rapidly screen the types of drugs circulating in Glasgow, for example, and be able to provide an early alert to unsafe substances?
Yeah, my understanding is that they will incorporate a drug checking service as part of the facility going forward if the licence is approved for that. And that would obviously be an ideal location for it. But like you say, with Wedinoffs, people then have to wait a few days or whatever for getting the results. So it's not like that immediacy that you would get with a proper rollout of drug checking, where it would be like your results in 20 minutes and some advice attached to that, which would be the ideal scenario.
Thank you. And finally, Paul O'Kane.
No, thanks, Convener. The last question I was going to ask in the context of MAT standards was just about the timescale that's been offered by the Minister in terms of 2025, April of 25 for full implementation, given the challenges and the opportunities I think you've outlined. I know it's hard to say, but, you know, are we on track essentially to have, I suppose, a meaningful delivery by that date? And just a view, because we have the Minister next. So
I think we know. So I think we know what ADPs are reporting and what's been reported back in terms of implementation. But one of the other stories I got from my staff this week was about somebody trying to get a prescription from the chemist for an opiate substitute therapy. They'd had an overdose, gone into hospital, come out on the Monday. They were told to go to the chemist on the Wednesday to pick up what they needed. It wasn't available. They went again on the Thursday, not available. Friday, not available. No explanation or urgency about it. On the Saturday, they decided to use street heroin again because they couldn't get access to what they needed. They survived that. But actually, you know, that is in the context of the MAT standards being implemented. So we need all bits of the system, back to the system, all bits of the system to really be treating this with the urgency it deserves. And not, I just genuinely feel if someone in that pharmacy was looking for, like, you know, a heart medication or a diabetes medication, there would have been much more urgency about getting that and recognising that this is actually life-saving. But not everybody is on board yet around the MAT standards. But I would agree with Kirsten's phrase before about, you know, could see progress, but too slow and there's not enough. And 2025, I think, will, you know, when families tell us it's happening, I'll believe it's happening.
Yeah.
I think from our perspective, I mean, we have seen significant progress, and we hope that that is reflected in the 2024 benchmarking report that's due out in summer. And we will know definitely if that's the case. However, regardless, as we've described, MAT is one part of it, and we are so very, very much aware that whilst we have made significant progress, there's still a huge amount of work and improvements that we are really keen and committed to driving forward locally.
One quick
final word, yeah. Say that I agree with everything that's been said, but also we all need to broaden our horizons in terms of the substances that we are addressing through MAT standards. And to, I wanted to come in on your previous question that you'd asked about parity with the third sector, and that we really should have prescribing services available within the third sector services that we have as well, so that people have that choice of location as well as where they get their prescribing. And I think we would see a dramatic improvement in terms of the MAT standards as well if we did that approach.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, that just brings us neatly up to time. So can I just thank you all for joining us this morning? It's been a really helpful update. So thank you again, and we'll just have a short suspension for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Thank you very much, members. So I'd now like to welcome our second panel of witnesses to our meeting this morning. So can I welcome Christina McKelvey, Minister for Drugs and Alcohol Policy, and congratulations on your new role. Michael Crook, Head of Harm Reduction Team, and Alison Crockett, Unit Head, Whole Systems Unit, Drugs Policy Division at the Scottish Government, and Dr. Saket Priyadarshi, Associate Medical Director of the Glasgow Alcohol and Drug Recovery Services. So a warm welcome to you all. So can I just ask the Minister to make some brief opening remarks? Minister.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. Thank you for having me along to your committee and giving me the opportunity to update you on work underway through our national mission to reduce drug-related deaths and harms. I've been in post now for nearly 3 months, so not quite as new, Convener, and I want to thank my predecessors for laying a solid foundation on which I'm able to build, and all the people working in this sector across Scotland. I've had the real privilege and pleasure of meeting many of them over the last few weeks. Since taking on the portfolio, I've made it clear that my commitment around continuing our national mission, following the evidence of what works to reduce drug deaths, whilst ensuring we are providing a full range of treatment options so that individuals are able to obtain support wherever they are with their substance use and recovery journey. I've been clear in my desire to approach this matter in a cross-party, cross-UK manner. Problem substance use has no respect for borders, and with some of the challenges we're facing, along with the new threats related to synthetic opioids, it's vital that we work together to tackle all of these. In the short time I have been in post, Convener, I've met with a range of stakeholders, but also with people directly affected by substance use, those using substances, their families and their friends, and people who generally just love them. I've heard and learned a lot about those issues most impacting all of their lives. And Convener, recently I had a visit to the Bothy, which was one of the first visits I did in Edinburgh, and Craig Miller, to hear from the peer mentors and the work that they are doing in that community to support people. Incredibly inspirational, but also to see the work that when communities, particularly recovery communities and other communities, come together with local organisations, national organisations and the statutory sector, you can see real change and hope for people in their lives. And that was what really touched me that day, was the hope that peer mentors who live, work and support people in those communities have that lived experience. And one of the persons who's using that service says to me, it's really helpful when you take that big step to walk through that door, that somebody at the other side is saying, I understand, I know where you are, I've been there. And that's incredibly powerful. The other part of that is about how we engage and support the workforce. And I was really pleased to be along at Glasgow City Chambers the other week at the graduation ceremony for the people who were undertaking the addiction worker training, which will now be renamed as a national traineeship. The hope and the joy and the dedication and the commitment and the opportunity now for those people to go into the workforce and support the work that we need to do was very, very clear on the day. I was sad to leave it. I had to come back to Parliament to vote that day, but it was a joy to be in the room with so many people who have taken their experience and turned that into a qualification and will now use that to be in the workforce, and just to see how proud their families were. Again, you know, something that's just absolutely amazing to see. Convener, it's clear that the national mission has changed how we think about these issues and how we respond to these issues too, not least due to the work of the many, many partners driving this forward, including those you have just heard from. Today I managed to catch some of the brilliant evidence that they gave you in the work that they are doing and the challenges that they give me as a government minister to do more and better. But also the work of Dr. Priyadarshi, and who's beside me today, who's a real champion for this work, and you'll be very privileged and honoured to hear from his evidence today too. Nevertheless, I think we have seen a rise in suspected drug-related death figures. I don't take any of that unseriously. I take it very, very seriously. After we welcomed that reduction last year, coupled with a very real threat we are seeing now from new substances and behaviours, it's vital that my focus remains on delivering what the evidence says works and making sure that it has the effect I think that we all want to see. Convener, I'll finish there because I know you have a lot of questions, and thank you from myself and no doubt from Dr. Sackett as well. He'll be happy to answer your questions as well as me, but thanks very much for having me along.
Thank you, Minister. That's really helpful. We had a very interesting panel session with panel one this morning, and I think we'll just begin as we began with our witnesses on the today's reporting around the increase in recorded suspected drugs deaths, but also a sort of noticeable decrease in hospital admissions. So we were just looking at what are the kind of causes behind that, those two changes. So I'd just open it up and ask for your own reflections on those figures and where we go from here.
Yeah. Convener, those quarterly figures are incredibly important for us to see emerging trends and emerging issues coming through as well. We won't have the full picture until we get the National Records of Scotland's data in the summer. And you know, I need to give that caveat around the radar figures and the police figures too, because we won't know what's been in the system and what's contributing to the rise that we're seeing. I think one thing that we are recognising, and right across the UK, I met with Minister Chris Philp just the other week, is the issues around about what else is coming into the supply chain now. The poly drug use that people are being involved in, the fact that the Home Office told us maybe 6 to 9 months heroin will run out, and that's now being supplemented by other opioids, synthetic opioids, benzodiazepines, and people shifting to injecting cocaine as well. So it's a very, very complex environment, particularly around about some of the data on poly drug use and, you know, what's the contributing factors there. So we're looking at all of that. Public Health Scotland are looking at all of that. We're hoping to get to a position when we have drug checking facilities in place, where we have sort of a live data, which will allow us to respond quicker as well, so that when an incident arises, you know, we can get in there and pivot services to support people in the appropriate way, both to reduce harm and reduce drug deaths too. Nonetheless, every single one of those persons is someone who's loved. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, somebody, maybe your neighbour, maybe your friend, maybe one of your family members. And I don't think we should ever forget that every single one of those deaths is someone who's grieved and loved. And it's certainly for me, that's the attitude I take. My condolences to anybody that's lost anybody that they have loved. But it's a really serious, complex issue, and we need to understand what's happening to engage those services, but also to allow us to reduce harm and therefore deaths.
Thank you. I'll maybe bring in Dr. Priyadarshi, just if you've got any kind of comments on these latest statistics that have been in the media today.
Yep, thank you, convener. Not really a huge amount to add to the minister's introduction and the response there, but from a Glasgow perspective, we know that, unfortunately, after a very significant reduction, confirmed reduction in 2022, we're likely to see an increase in drug-related death figures for the city in 2023, based on the suspected police drug-related death police data. And as the Minister said, understanding this will take some time because of the dynamic nature of the drugs market and the drug trends in Scotland at the moment. But some of the sort of obvious headlines that we're seeing at the moment are that actually the profile of people, unfortunately, who are dying of a drug-related death remains similar to the previous years. Most of the drugs involved remain the same in terms of polysubstance use, but what we have seen is a change in the benzodiazepines that are coming through from forensic toxicology, unfortunately. And you heard in the last session about the delays in forensic toxicology, so that intelligence comes to us months down the line, unfortunately. But we have seen a change in the benzodiazepine profile from etisalam to bromazolam. And so we think that might be a contributor as part of poly substance use. usually drug-related deaths and hospital admissions tend to be, the trends tend to mirror each other up and down the way. If there's been a separation in that trend, and I'd need to examine the data a bit more closely, you know, that's something that's different and something that, you know, I think would take some degree of analysis to understand.
Thank you for that. Thank you. If I can just come back to the Minister very quickly before I open up questions to members. And in the first panel session, there were some questions around stigma, and that introduced some discussion about the Charter of Rights for people affected by substance misuse. And I was very interested to hear about the Charter work. I think that had been highlighted in one of our submissions. I'm just interested in a wee bit more about the work that's going on to develop the Charter, and so what are the objectives with that work?
Well, thanks very much, Convener. And just a final point on the last question, mm-hmm. is one of the pieces of work that we are doing is to try and roll out naloxone kits. I think now about mm-hmm. 7 out of 10 people who are identified by services of being most at risk are now carrying naloxone kits. So, a really clear intervention on how we can reduce harm and reduce deaths as well. So that's just an additional point to the points I made earlier. On stigma, it's not unknown to any of us the amount of stigma that has been directed to anyone who has a substance dependency, not just them, but to their families and in communities as well. And that stigma is a real barrier for people seeking support. So one of the things that the National Mission were tasked to do was to look at stigma and to look at the discrimination and how we can change that. It's not difficult to understand where that comes from, given that the Reservation on the Equality Act mm-hmm. means that, you know, a certain group of people don't deserve the same rights as anybody else. We would like to change that. However, the stigma, both in systems and in communities and amongst people as well, has been signposted to us as a huge barrier for anybody accessing services. And that gets nuanced when it's people from specific communities or it's people who have different caring responsibilities. Mums, for instance, are very, you know, it's very difficult for them to take that step over the threshold and ask for help. Because of that stigma and the fear that they'd lose their children too. So Professor Alan Miller was tasked with coming up with a Charter of Rights, which is in draft form right now and is currently being consulted by the excellent organisations who have sat round the table to develop that work. Mm-hmm. I was along at the Alliance headquarters in Glasgow on Friday morning with the Change Group, who are a group of people who are delivering frontline services, organisations like those organisations you heard from this morning, and people with lived and living experience who are sitting at the table developing this work on what a Charter of Rights should look like. So, as I say, it is in draft form, it's out for consultation, and we hope to bring that forward. And that's a bit of a foundation for our Human Rights Bill, the bigger Human Rights Framework Bill that we want to bring forward as well. Because if we change the attitude to stigma and we shift all of this very clearly into a public health rights arena, then it changes the complexion of all of it. It means people have the same rights and deserve the same parity of health esteem as anybody else. And I think that's an incredibly important piece of work to do to change that cultural attitude.
Thank you. I think, am I right in thinking you maybe want to come in with a supplementary?
On stigma?
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be helpful. Thank you very much. Just come to the right page. An SDDT report from 2020 described abstinence as, quote, a notion based in stigma. And my question is there a risk that rejecting an abstinence or recovery approach because it could be seen as stigmatising will actually make things worse for those people who want to be drugs-free?
Excellent question, and from the Scottish Government's point of view, we think we need a range of services that suit the individual needs of an individual. So, you know, whether it's abstinence, whether it's medicated managed services, whether it's stabilisation services, whether it's detox in a community or detox in a unit, or it's other recovery interventions, I think we need all of them. to truly offer a person-centred approach to their recovery pathway, the one that works for them.
There seems to be a perception that there's a sort of significant fault line between those who believe in harm reduction model and those who believe in abstinence and recovery. And I know it's not necessarily either or, as you just said, but that does appear to be a very strong perception among some people who believe that much more should be done by the government to support recovery. Would you have any views on the spending and how the money's spent and more money should be put there?
So you'll not be surprised that government will be pulled in all different ways, because some people will think this is the best way to do it and other people will think this is the best way to do it. I'm taking my lead from the people who I've met very recently who are either in recovery or have just finished recovery, or like yesterday when I was at Abbey Care, I met all of those groups of people, plus people who have completed recovery and are now volunteering back into the service. And all of them say to me, you know, that they tried this approach or they tried that approach and they had not worked for them, but this approach did. And then I'm hearing from other people who are in other recovery pathways who are not, it's not abstinence based, it's maybe just stabilisation, who are saying, I needed to be stable first to get everything else in my life sorted out, to allow me to then think about the pathway to abstinence as well. So I think if we truly want to take that, you know, person-centred approach, we need to take into account all of those views, but we need to provide all of the services for the people who are telling me what works for them.
Yeah. Can I come on to something else? Yeah, sorry.
Oh. I think, Ros McCall, you'd like to come in with another supplementary. And then
I would, thank you. It's back on stigma again, Minister, and thank you very much indeed. And I know this was at the previous committee, unfortunately, prior to your post, so sorry about that, but the evidence we took was anticipate. By the time we get into the spring, we'll have a lot more information about the Stigma Action Plan and what that's going to be. And, of course, that is number 10 in the recommendations, to produce a Stigma Action Plan and rapidly put that in force. Now, the last panel we had, we got evidence there that there is a bit of a disconnect. It's unclear communication, certainly isn't rapid. And the stigma is still there as a strong factor stopping people actually moving forward for the support that's available and that they need. So can you update us today on what the action plan is going to be on stigma, where it's moving, how quickly we're going to get that in place, and actually give us some meat to the bones rather than it's out for consultation? Can we have a little bit more information, please?
I can write to the committee with a much more detailed report on where we are with the stigma plan and the work that's being done. I don't disagree with some of your points. We would all want this work to have been done yesterday. And I think we would not be here now in some of the ways in which we approach people with a dependency had we tackled stigma a long time ago. And that's just generally UK and global wide, I think. So that's one point. The other point is that the people with lived and living experience that I met with on Saturday morning, I came through Edinburgh Saturday morning, met with a group who are working on this particular piece of work, really, and the change group that I met with on Friday, they want this to be right. So it's very hard to take a human rights approach to participation and co-production if we then say, well, we need to get this done by, you know, 4 weeks on Friday. That's just not worked for this group of people. They need some time to work all this through. It doesn't answer, you know, your question so far. I can, you know, come back, because we only met at the weekend, so let me get you know, a much clearer update and timeline of where we were. But I'll take you back to the people who were speaking to me on Saturday. They want this to be right. They want massive change, because it is massive cultural change, and they want that at every level of public service and other services that they come into contact with. So that's the important part of it. And, you know, it's not an answer to how quick and how far have we progressed. There is a draft charter there now. I think that's good to mark to progress. And we can certainly, you know, make sure that we can share that with this committee as well, if they want to see the draft work. And Professor Alan Miller, who's leading this work, is well known for you know, being a real driver for change in all of this, would no doubt be happy to speak with you too.
I appreciate the answer, Minister. Thank you very much. I know I put you on the spot a little bit there. I'm sure I'll return to it at the next meeting, and I'm sure you'll have an update for me then. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks. Okay, I'll bring in Pauline McNeill and then Claire Hawley.
Still the morning. Good morning. Thank you. Minister, I wanted to ask you what you'd said about human rights framework, and maybe just expand on what you meant by some parity of health esteem. Now, I've got some knowledge about alcohol addiction, and I would say it goes beyond stigma. So the NHS is not keen to admit people who are still drinking, for example, but may be desperate to get some help, unless, of course, you know, there is a very serious condition, like a cardiac arrest or something like that. Is that what you meant by parity of health esteem, or is it something else?
So it's that, and the fact that the way the Equality Act is worded and the reservations that it has, so that anybody who has a dependency, alcohol or drugs, who that has not been a consequence of a medical intervention, don't have the same rights as everybody else. They're carved out as being reserved. And so therefore, the way that systems and public authorities and health boards and have approached this is from that perspective. So that's the foundation of the discrimination in my eyes. And it should change. What that's created then is that you know, systematic discrimination where people are feeling they can't get the actions or the services they need. One of the reasons for driving up the MAT standards was to tackle some of that and to tackle some of the issues where you hear people who have maybe felt as if they have been passed from pillar to post, whether it's you sort out your dependency before your alcohol issue, sort out your alcohol issue before your your drug dependency, or sort out your mental health issue before this. We want to make sure that's a joined up approach that person is getting. But there's a foundational structural inequality in everything that we do in Scotland and the UK based on that reservation and the impact that then has on how services are mm-hmm. delivered. And that needs to change.
And that's helpful. I mean, in one view, you can understand why an A&E room would say, you know, we're not admitting someone who's got an alcohol problem, even though they're desperate to get off alcohol or drugs for that matter, because they say, well, it's not, maybe another service should be dealing with that, but that's the problem.
Yeah.
You can't just ring up and say, I'd like to have a rehab bed, please. Or it's just, it seems to be like a long gap between someone calling for help and actually getting help.
Yeah, yeah, and that MAT Standard 1 is about that same day intervention, which is a huge change as well.
Yeah.
Don't, Thackett, you were sitting nodding your head away there, so I don't know whether you agree with me or you've got other experience given your medical experience.
Yeah, happy to make a comment if that's welcome.
Please, that'd be great, thank you.
First of all, a declaration. I'm working with Professor Miller with the National Collaborative as a duty bearer, as a part of a number of workshops that the National Collaborative is conducting to really sort of examine the Charter of Rights and to think about an effective implementation plan for them. And I'm very happy to contribute to that work because I think it's really crucial for the people that I see as a clinician and as a medical manager as well. Their experiences aren't universal, but undoubtedly stigma and discrimination are sort of, are often day-to-day experiences for them, not just from, you know, society and members of the public, but unfortunately from a whole range of services that they're looking to access and seek support from as well. So I very strongly welcome the Charter of Rights, and I think we're really keen to see it implemented effectively. We've got great sort of plans and proposals often, but it's in the implementation and monitoring the effectiveness of it that it's really important. I think there are two elements that are important for us. One to note first is the MAT standards from a drug services perspective has got us, there's quite a lot of overlap with the National Collaborative work, so it's pulled us along in the right direction. But of course, people need a whole range of services, and just in health, from primary care to acute services as well. And I think we need to bring them on board. And secondly, I think taking a health-based approach and a trauma and psychologically informed approach and an inequality-sensitive approach. And I know I've put a lot of buzzwords into one sentence there, but you know, they do have meanings behind them. taking that sort of approach into a wider range of statutory and third sector services and responses is really important, and I think the draft charter will play its, or the Charter of Rights will play its part in that, hopefully.
Thank you. Could I follow up on a separate question? I'd raised the issue with the previous panel about some of the concerns that the public have in Glasgow around the saver consumption rooms. And I'm sure you agree that it's really important that the community also feels that it's been run well. So wondered if you comment on that, and also for those users who may want to make that transition, if you like, to rehabilitation, does it allow for that?
Yeah. So, first, there was always a plan to do an engagement process around the drug consumption facility once we had some legal framework to base that on. So, and you'll know that the Lord Advocate's letter to the Glasgow HSCP makes it clear that she expected a robust engagement process. And we began that immediately after receiving the letter. So I went to a public meeting at the end of September in 2023. And since then, we've done a very large number of engagement sessions with the local community, local businesses, also with third sector partners, with people with lived experience, and crucially, and families, and crucially, people with living experience who are likely to be potential service users of the facility. The range of feedback that we've received is very broad. So at one end, you know, you have people who are very sort of keen to see it implemented and be successful. You have folk who understand the model and the rationale, but have some concerns. And I'll come back to the concerns in a bit more detail. There are people who are ambivalent about it. And then at the other end, you have people who are ideologically very sort of opposed. Mm-hmm. From the community's perspective, the concerns that we consistently hear back are the ones that are heard across the world at the whenever these services are proposed and initially implemented. So they are things around, will this service bring more people into our area? And we're talking about the Carlton area of Glasgow. Will there be more visible drug use and more visible drug problems? Will there be issues in relation to open drug dealing and potentially between drug dealers as well, and how will police respond to all of this, and how will our concerns and our experience be taken into account as the service is implemented? So we have regular open sessions for members of the public to come and speak to us about this. We've created a web page with a set of responses. We have a frequently asked questionnaire, and we've got a video around this. We're working with police colleagues as well around how we work with them once the service is implemented to recognise and manage the concerns of businesses and community. And in due course, we will have once the service is ready for implementation, we plan to have a community forum. It's a model that's been developed in other parts of the world, where the service doesn't just do engagement before it's implemented, but actually continues to engage at the point of implementation and actually for a long time afterwards, so that, you know, there's a service representative, and we hope Police Scotland and other representatives on that forum who will be able to respond to community concerns and have an open communication stream with them, as well as regular set meetings to understand the impact, negative or positive. We think there's obviously our case for a drug consumption in the facility is based on benefits for the community and the society at large as well. So it's located at a site where we know around it are a number of public injecting sites, and public injection is unfortunately very common. And in fact, a lot of people who are engaging with us, in fact, virtually everybody from the community who's engaged with us, has their own personal experience of seeing and being impacted by public injecting in their area, in their closes, in their back gardens, in their front gardens, in the parks, immediately outside, in car parks and spaces. So we, listening to that feedback, we kind of get a sense that we're locating it in the right place, because that's exactly where the population is involved in this. But we hope that we're able to demonstrate for them that once we do this, there'll be a very significant reduction in that day-to-day impact that they currently experience. And that tends to have been the experience in other services across the world. You did have a second question, sorry, which was about recovery. The model of care is based on being able to offer people opportunities through peers who work in the service into a whole range of recovery communities, rehabs, treatments, and other services that they want and need.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll bring in Claire Hawkey and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. I've just got that in under the wire. Minister, you may have seen in the previous session that I asked the panel about synthetic opioids, and I note that you've mentioned those in your opening statement, and about the threats that they pose and the increased risk. There was a gentle challenge back from the panel, and I hope I'm not quoting them, I'm paraphrasing here, that perhaps there might be too much focus on synthetic opioids, and we are already seeing people's lives impacted and indeed people dying from current drug use, not only or previous to synthetic opioids coming into the picture. So I suppose I'm keen to hear from you what the government and your officials are doing to address that threat, and what additional measures you're putting in place in terms of synthetic opioids.
It's maybe worth, Ms. Hawkey, thank you for your question. It's maybe worth hearing some of the international evidence around synthetics, the challenge that they pose, the fact that they're now being mixed in with other substances when people don't know, so you're getting contaminated substances that people don't know about, and the fact that they're 50 to 500 times more powerful. So the not being prepared for that coming down the line is my gentle argument back. We have to be prepared for that coming down the line, and we need to be very aware of what's being seen in the rest of the world. The first week I was in this role, I took part in a round table with colleagues from Canada, New York and Ireland, on synthetics and the actions that they've been able to take to tackle situations where they see this in the supply chain and how dangerous it can actually be. It's one of the reasons why drug checking facilities then the national hub will become very important, because we should see that coming in and then being able to pivot towards an alert system, which I think Public Health Scotland have already used to alert people there's something there that's not safe. Please check it out, or be safe when you're administering that. So there's that. What I'm also hearing is this shift for people moving into using benzodiazepines, or it's contaminating the substance that they've got and they don't realise it's there, and the impact that's having. And then this shift also for people moving to injecting cocaine, and all of the health issues that come along with that. And of course, we don't have an naloxone for stimulants. There's no treatment right now for stimulants, and we've got a huge amount of work to do there as well. So I'm taking quite a broad approach, but it might just be because synthetics are, in the news, at the top of everybody's agenda right now, and they pose such a threat that's what we're seeing. That's not my experience here. It is what I'm experiencing as far as being alert to this, but the other work that's ongoing in all the other areas is ongoing, and we're hearing from stakeholders about how that behaviour is changing and issues are being dealt with, and how we can then intervene at that point, either through them or through other services. But it is a big threat, I don't think we can downplay it, but I would be given my commitment that we're not just looking at that, we're looking at to all of the other information. And the toxicology results we get in the summer from the NRS with all of that really rich data will give us some indication of what's been happening last year. And certainly the radar results are telling us that benzodiazepines and cocaine are playing a bigger part maybe than they used to do. If I can ask Alison to come in, because Alison takes part in lots of international work. She's got a long experience in this, and we'll maybe give you an overview of what the global picture is and how we're using that to inform the work that we're doing here.
Yeah, we've been part of the debate in the Commission on Narcotic Drugs with regard to synthetics, and been really trying to take what we can from the information that other countries are experiencing and what they're doing that works. And the truth is, were synthetics to come in the way that it has done in North America or in some other parts of Europe, we will be seeing much greater, distress and problems than even we have now, which is really alarming given our experiences already is really difficult to date. And I think to go to your point, I think that the best evidence that we have at the moment is that actually what we're doing now, if we're doing it, to the extent, if we're scaling up and making sure that services are as available as they can be, and that we're addressing people's needs, that point of saying that they need them, there really isn't a panacea. There's not something. No one yet has found a way of addressing a synthetics epidemic in their country. And I think that's what we need. So what we can do is be as available as we can, scale up the things that we do know work, the drug checking, the ability to access a service, perhaps, looking at our prescription, looking at, talking about stigma and looking at how do we how do we reduce the barriers for anyone accessing a service to the extent that we can. That is the key points, I think, that we need to ensure that we do not do something new or different, but really make sure that what we know works. From the best information that we've gleaned from other countries is available to people as they ask for it.
Yeah. Okay. And just on the point of cocaine, I said we don't have a naloxone for cocaine overdose or harm. The only option is supervised detox. That's the only form of recovery there, and Cocaine Anonymous and other organisations are very helpful and supporting people in that situation. So it's why the increase in residential rehab beds, the increase in delivery of frontline services becomes more important. So it's not just that synthetics is a new thing in town. We're still attempting to deal with some more traditional substances like cocaine, but trying to tackle it in a way that will promote reducing harm and deaths, but also give people a recovery pathway.
Thank you for that answer. And before I continue on, I refer members to my register of interest. I'm a nurse with a bank nurse contract with Great Glasgow and Clyde NHS, and recently worked in ADRS in GGNC. Can I just go on then? You touched briefly there on toxicology. And I think earlier on in a previous answer, there was someone had mentioned toxicology and delays in toxicology. So what work's being done to ensure that we get toxicology results back in a more efficient manner, not only for the academic interest, but also for families?
So families want answers, and sometimes that's the answer. Sadly, that's the answer that they get. So toxicology becomes very, very important in giving families an understanding. It then gives everybody else in the care and treatment of people an understanding of what that toxicology tells us. The radar reports is a sort of a three-monthly, brings in a few things, but brings in toxicology results primarily to see what's in the system. It's all incredibly important, but it's all after the fact. There's one thing about learning about what the causes are, how do we prevent and create the treatment pathways that prevents people from coming to harm and losing their life. So we're working very, very hard with toxicology colleagues, the drug checking facility. So,
sorry, Minister, can you just stick to toxicology? So I guess my question's quite specific about what's happening in terms of speeding up toxicology results.
So we're obviously, from my perspective, the RADAR results being quarterly are the way that we're looking at that and trying to scale all of that up. General toxicology is a huge challenge and issue as well. And for me, I think whether any of my officials have got an update, but I think that information on the general issue would come from the Health Minister, and I'm happy to elicit that information and bring it back to you.
If yourself or one of your officials could maybe write to committee with that update.
No, I think absolutely.
It's an important issue that's raised with me as a constituency MSP. I think it's also very important in terms of giving people answers. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Russell Finlay, followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a question for Dr. Priyadarshi about the Glasgow Drugs Consumption Facility. When is it opening?
So the official wording we've used is late summer this year. I think to give you a bit more detail around that, the dependencies around the building work that's required, which start at the start of March. We're expecting a handover date sometime in August, hopefully at the end of August, and therefore we hope to have the staff recruited and able to deliver a service immediately.
So if handovers late August, late summer sounds a bit ambitious, it's more like the autumn, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we're heading unfortunately into early autumn possibly. Yeah. So I think September, early September is hopefully a date we can be.
I mean, the submission from Suzanne Miller to the committee said hopefully be implemented by late summer, so that sounds like that's not the case it's going to be. Like, so there's also issues around recruitment. You've struggled to get staff, is that correct?
For this facility, we have already recruited some senior members of staff. I'm here today, whereas there's a recruitment event happening to attract the frontline staff who'll deliver services. So it's fair to say that alcohol and drug services have had challenges in recruiting and retaining frontline staff. But for this service, we seem to actually have had a lot of interest, and there's hope that we will be able to recruit the multidisciplinary team that we have the complement of.
Right. But the initial advertising, there wasn't as good a response as you'd have liked, I think. Is that correct?
No, I think it was a really positive response for the operational manager and the nurse team leader posts. We've had fantastic response, more than we get for most posts in the service.
There was a previous witness this morning and previous evidence that these committees talked about the need for the facility to also use smoking facilities, inhalation, and so on, and that ran up against, we understand from the last evidence session, the smoking ban. Do you know if there's any... Have you sought to overcome that particular hurdle, or is it not going to include these?
So the service that will be implemented will start with 8 injecting booths and not an inhalation room. Unfortunately, the original proposal in 2016 was to hopefully include inhalation rooms as well. But we found 3 challenges around that. One, it relates to the smoking legislation itself and certain elements of it. The other is the actual technical ventilation aspects of an inhalation room are quite challenging and would require quite significant capital investment as well. And the third is that we're locating it in the Hunter Street Health and Social Care Centre in the Carlton area. And at the moment, the footprint of that building gives us some limitations about the range of interventions we can put in. So we made the decision to begin with the injecting booths as our first ask of the Lord Advocate, and that will be evaluated and monitored. And if we feel that we need to add to that, then I hope we will be able to make some further representations in the future.
That's interesting. Thank you. I was going to ask a question of the Minister around prisons. Now, many of Scotland's prisons have got significant drugs problems. Many prisoners don't get any treatment of any type. And some prisoners go into prison without a drug problem and come out with one. The UK government has recently created drugs-free wings in 45 prisons in England and Wales, and are set to more than double that. These feature substance misuse courses, regular drug testing, and in addition, they've got plans for 18 drug recovery wings where prisoners will receive 6 months of intensive abstinence-based treatment. I know we've touched on abstinence issues earlier. I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government has any plans to offer anything similar to prisoners in Scotland.
So I really welcome the work that's been done in England and Wales. I had the pleasure of being in Berlinia last Thursday night. Yes, they did let me back out. But when I was going along to that, and I was saying to a colleague, I'm going along to the Berlinia tonight, they thought, well, that must be grim. But actually it wasn't, because they've been running a recovery cafe and a creative change programme for almost 8 years now. And I was able to hear from the people who have taken part in that process, and not just the fact that they were dry and clean now for many, many weeks and months, but all of the other changes that allowed them to focus on their general health and well-being. So many of them were at the gym and, you know, given real attention to their general health and well-being, but also to their mental health and well-being. And what really struck me was the camaraderie of the groups of men who were encouraging each other to take part, which is a real cultural change in that type of setting. I'm not saying that we've tackled all of the issues. You may have seen some of the publicity over the last couple of days about Glenelco and the work that they're doing there with recovery, and it's the same in, what's the other one that's in the north of Glasgow? You'll know. Lomas. The same, that there's recovery work going in, in all of these areas too.
What about this idea of drug-free wings? Is that on the table? Has that been discussed with SPS? Or?
So SPS are currently working with us on what they think would work. What I was really struck with when I was in Berlinia on Thursday night was the way that the prison officers there worked with the people involved. There was a real respect to each other's role and their journey. So we're working very closely with SPS and how they would see some of this rolling out. But we're now seeing in some of the particularly Glenelg, I think, where there is now a drug-free wing, and work has been done to look at how that operates and look at how we can then roll it out across all prisons.
Oh, so there's actually one up and running in Glenelg?
Yeah.
Right, okay. Because, I mean, prison officers often now increasingly are becoming exposed to inhalation of dangerous substances, becoming unwell as a consequence. So it just seems like an obvious thing to do. If you've got a cohort of prisoners who desperately want to be in an environment where there's no risk of coming across narcotics that are going to harm them.
And everybody needs to be safe in their workplace, absolutely. One of the things about synthetics is that some of them are much more dangerous to people working in the sector as well, and something that we have to consider when working through the support for workforce, as well as ensuring that people are both safe at their work and safe wherever they are.
I will cut you off as usual, and I will come back to you if there is time. So I'm going to bring in Paul Sweeney and then Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks to the panel for their contributions so far. At the last cross-committee meeting in November, we heard from Suzanne Miller from the Glasgow Health and Social Care Partnership that evaluation should be ready to start as soon as the pilot launches, just heard sort of early September, hopefully. Is that still expected to be the case? And what criteria will the facility be measured against?
Do you want me to? So thanks very much. Yes, the evaluation work is very much part of the implementation plan. It's led and coordinated by Dr. Amelia Crichton, the Director of Public Health, but it's being coordinated and delivered by a whole range of independent academics, and we're very fortunate to have four academic departments across the UK who are keen to be part of this work. And they're supported by Public Health Scotland as well. The baseline work we're hoping we can do right now. So there's a lot of examining of current data that'll tell us what the baseline is compared to the post-implementation data. The evaluation itself will focus on a whole range of different outcomes for a whole range of different stakeholders in this. So obviously, crucially for people who use services, there's health and social care outcomes that we want to examine. So everything from overdoses to fatal overdoses, hospital admissions, bloodborne virus transmissions and wounds, injecting-related wounds, all the way to, you know, for the community, discarded litter, their experience, their feeling of safety in the area as well. So it's a very comprehensive plan. It's built on international evidence base, but has very localized sort of feel to it. So it's about what are the local issues for this group of people who will use the service and for the local community in the Carlton area. There's also obviously a significant element which is about the cost effectiveness of the service.
That's really helpful. Will there be ongoing real-time evaluation and indeed flexibility to make operational adjustments as things arise? Say, for example, one of the things that was raised at the last meeting was opening hours, the Copenhagen model is a 24-hour service, for example. These kind of things, potentially, could these be adjusted?
Yes, absolutely. So there's research and there's, you know, day-to-day monitoring of the service. The evaluation, the full evaluation, will take some time, but we will be monitoring the service with regular reports to understand the impact of the service and to look at areas in which it might develop. So, for example, two areas we are already thinking about is how do we understand whether the opening times have been effective, just as you described, and whether they need a degree of adjustment. And the second is, I think you touched on this in your earlier part of the discussions, is around the needs of women and how can the service meet the needs of women within the sort of confines and restrictions that it has.
That's really helpful. Thanks very much. I just wanted to turn to the Minister and ask what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the scalability of this model. We spoke about some of the capital constraints around inhalation, for example, and the operational model that's been deployed. Has there been consideration given to how easy this would be to potentially scale?
So that's the work that Dr. Priyajasi just spoken about there, and that continuous monitoring and evaluation and what works and what doesn't work and how we can, you know, modify that to work. We will be keeping that monitoring view on how the consumption room operates and what it will deliver. One thing, if I can say about the building of it, the architects came up with a plan and then the Simon Communities Women's Group worked with them to bring about a new design that was much more, they felt much more user-friendly. So even at that stage, that we have had people with lived and living experience in influencing what the actual structure of the building should look like and how things should flow. And that's been incredibly helpful because it allows us then to design out some of the barriers that sometimes are designed in when it comes to building a facility as well. You ask about scalability. So the Lord Advocate's been very clear about the very clear guidance she's given us on this consumption room, whether we can scale that up and have consumption rooms in other places, you know, that will be certainly something that we will be considering. When I visited Aberdeen a few weeks ago, I met with AIDA, their organisation there, and they were the first people to get their licence application in for a drug checking facility. But one of the things that they were saying to me is we're watching what's happening in Glasgow to see if there's something, you know, that will work for us. And I think given how sensitive the siting of a service like that is and the impact on the community and, you know, how people will react to that, I think taking that very measured approach and allowing local areas to decide what locally will work for them. Mm-hmm. So it's a much more flexible view, but within the confines of how much we can actually do as far as Glasgow within the confines of the Lord Advocate's guidance, and then how we can use that in other ways across the country as well. But I think there's lots of cities with eyes on what's happening in Glasgow, and we'll be really interested in the real-time evaluation and how they would think it would work for their areas. And I think we need to leave that space to allow that to develop.
Okay. Is there any other comments from colleagues?
I mean, I think the only other thing to add to that would be that we are aware that other cities are doing work. So we know that, for example, Edinburgh have taken a strong interest in what's happening in Glasgow. They've done their own sort of scoping exercise as well and have a real interest. And as the Minister says, they recognise the need for different models, possibly citing it in one area as it is in Glasgow wouldn't work for Edinburgh. They have sort of a different challenge here. So there is that need to address alternatives and see how that would work. But again, that sort of issue around scalability, it will come back to really looking at the evaluation from Glasgow and how that works.
Also just wondered about peer review from other facilities around the world. Recently visited Copenhagen. I know that Rasmus Christiansen, who runs that facility, H17, had offered to come to Glasgow to potentially help brief members of the community about their experience of the difficulties in introduction and how they were able to, you know, resolve that with the police and so on. I just wondered if those conversations have been going on.
Yeah, so we meet regularly with international colleagues who've delivered these services and have experience of delivering them for over a decade. And Rasmus has been really helpful. So although he's not been here, we haven't been to Copenhagen, we have had a number of meetings, including with his police colleagues as well, and we've linked them up to police colleagues as well, so they can have separate conversations that don't involve the service. Sydney, Vancouver, the Norwegian drug consumption rooms, and as well. So we're not going with just our own ideas. We really listening closely and learning from international experience, both about the operational elements, but you're absolutely right about the community liaison elements. And that's why I was describing plans to have a regular community forum with identified members of the service who will respond to community queries and concerns as the service is implemented. And that's very much based on a lot of work that Rasmus has done, but also has been done elsewhere in the world.
Police Scotland's also developed their own guidance from learning from other parts of the world about how they will protect local communities as well, but, you know, create the circumstances in which we don't put more barriers in the way of people coming and seeking support.
That's great.
Yeah, I was just going to say we are also, from a Scottish Government point of view, have been in touch with, you know, as we said before, North America, but also Switzerland, Berlin. You know, there's a lot in Europe already, and you know, as well as the Copenhagen, and we have learned a lot from them, but also a raft of different models. And certainly we were talking to our colleagues in Canada in our last conversation about high tolerance housing. And, you know, different ways in which we can achieve similar objectives, you know, like keeping people safe, ensuring support, giving them access to services. But it's not always the same. It's not always the same model. And I think, as the Minister said, you know, in different parts of the country, perhaps, which may be more rural or who have different needs, it may not look exactly the same as that. It may, the achieving that objective may come from, you know, a different set of support services, and it's important for us to make sure that we support communities to reflect that in whatever it is they pursue.
We'll have to move things on. So we've got about 15 minutes or so left, and I've still got three members wanting to come in. So succinct questions and answers would be helpful. Colette Stevenson and then Paula Kane.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good afternoon to the Minister and the panel. I want to touch upon the drug check and pilot projects, which you have touched upon previously and in your opening statement, Minister. And we also heard evidence earlier from the first panel on it, and how, in terms of the pilots, how resource intensive it's been. So I wonder if you could provide an update on the expected timescales and processes for the setup of a drug checking facility in each of the areas that have been targeted, and also just how you see the impact of those facilities as well?
Yeah, no, thanks very much for the question. I'm really hopeful about drug checking facilities because I think it would give us real-time data on what's happening in a local area, but will also give us using the national hub, which would be sited between, you know, it's with Dundee University and Nine Wells Hospital, where they can do further analysis and get some real deep understanding. So that's one aspect about how we understand what's in the system. I was up at Aberdeen on the day that they submitted their licence application to the Home Office. There's already two drug checking facilities available. One is a postal one, Wedinos, which is based in Wales, and there's one in Bristol, and they've got the experience of going through the process and how tricky and complex that process has been. So we're leaning a lot on our friends in other parts of the UK to do this. We've got excellent, our officials have got excellent working relationships with the Home Office officials. And the criteria was designed to tackle all of that complexity, but also to make sure that whatever we're doing was, you know, within the law and we can maintain within the restrictions of the Misuse of Drugs Act. Putting all of that challenge aside, the determination to do this has resulted in many organisations working together. Where the facility would be sited, being in amongst a whole service that already gives other support, so you're not just coming in to get checked, you know, you're checking, you're being exposed to all of the other support that could be available to you there as well. And that's the Aberdeen one. I think the convener would be very interested in the Aberdeen facility. It's worth actually speaking with them and having you know, some time to visit with them. So they're the first to get their application in. It's taken a long time to get to where we need to be in order to meet all of the criteria, but theirs is in. Dundee's is in, and Glasgow's is imminent. They're working on theirs right now, officials with Home Office officials and the people who were delivering for Glasgow as well. That will give us results within minutes of whether a substance is more dangerous or not. As I say, it's only one pathway in which a person would maybe become exposed to all of the services available. So there's intervention points there that we can use to offer people support to. And the ability just to make an informed choice, you know, and getting the right advice for people. And that's why consumption rooms then become part of that whole system, because if someone then, you know, that doesn't look that safe, you know, that's the advice we're giving you, we'd maybe be somewhere safe where if they do take it and there's a reaction, they'll be looked after. And I think that's incredibly important, again, taking that harm reduction and reducing drug deaths approach. So there's multi-layers here. There's the practical stuff about what people will need to know and the decisions they'll need to make and giving them the confidence to do that. And then there's the data and the analysis and the understanding of actually is the profile of what we are seeing coming through the system changing. The other big aspect of that is if we immediately see, you know, an incident of an increase of something, you know, very dangerous in the system, then Public Health Scotland and other organisations will put out an alert. They've already did this once. Put out an alert to everybody who is on the front line and supporting people to let them know that something is in the system that's potentially 500 times more powerful than your usual and how dangerous that can be as well. So it's got all different reasons for why it's a good thing.
Thanks very much for that. That's been really helpful. I mean, one of the things we did here was that one of the things that works well was mobile units as well and not just within facilities. Would that be something that you've looked into, or would you be open to that going forward?
Yeah, no, we've looked into it. My previous a colleague in this role had looked into that, and some festivals have managed to do this. The Home Office are pretty rigid on it, but you know, so we're as I say, we're working with them. Mobile units at big events could be a lifesaver for some people. So my mind's not closed on it at all. But the challenges that we have with the Misuse of Drugs Act, which makes that really difficult to happen, and I think we've had some experience and asks from organisations to do it, but it's pretty rigid.
Yeah, just to excuse me, just to add to that. So The research work that was carried out by Stirling University into drug checking, one of the big things that came through that was the desire for sort of mobile units. As the Minister's alluded to when we've been in discussion with the Home Office about what would and wouldn't be considered in terms of a licence application, the Home Office have been quite clear that any facility would have to be a fixed site facility attached to an already existing drug or alcohol treatment service. So in terms of getting a new licence for a drug checking facility at the moment, that a mobile facility would be outside of the Home Office criteria, but it's something that we'll continue to speak to them about and work with.
And just finally, a quick question in terms of the applications that have already been put through to the Home Office. When do you envisage that you'll get a notification that they've been approved?
So I did ask the policing minister this a few weeks ago, and he said he would go and look at that. So we expect that there'll be a site visit arranged and some other back and forth about the actual facility. We would like it to happen now, but I suspect it will take a wee while for that to happen and for the site visits to happen as well. But we would hope that, once passed, the other ones should be academic in a sense, but with the same, rigorous quality control about whether all the criteria for operating a site has been met.
OK, thanks very much for that.
Paul O'Kane and then Sandish Gilhani.
Thank you very much, Convener. The Minister may have heard the previous section on MAT standards within, as I say, the previous evidence. I'm keen to get the Minister's view of her position on the implementation of MAT standards by the timescales set out, 2025, obviously, and I think embedded by 2026. Obviously, we heard quite a bit of evidence this morning about what's happening on the ground in terms of the challenges that exist, particularly in terms of needing a more holistic approach, perhaps, and maybe going beyond opioids and looking at the wider range of issues. So I wonder if she might want to comment on that.
Yeah, so obviously we set the MAT standards. We want everybody who's accessing a service gets that service at the highest quality, and that people are informed about the choices that they've got. And the MAT standards that are included in there, I mentioned earlier about the issue around about mental health and dependency. There's a specific MAT standard to tackle that. We're working really closely. I think the advice that I was given by both previous ministers in this role was, keep driving up the MAT standards and make sure your budget's protected. So two very, 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 very good pieces of advice coming into this role. I think we've obviously published in 2021, the work that's going on across the board to drive that up is not just in health services, across all services. And it's really a way to really push forward the idea that this is a health issue, therefore should be treated as a health issue, and that people should have a high quality of service. It's a bit of a change for people delivering the services, particularly in health boards, and how we increase all of those standards the way that we want to, giving people the choices that they need to do to make the right decisions for their health. We also are applying MAT standards to justice settings. So, the points made by Russell Finlay earlier about what's happening in prisons as well. We do have prison to rehab, and they're all covered by MAT standards as well. So, hoping to, make sure that covers everyone. There's great progress being made. I've got a really a great diagram here that allows me to see immediately where we're at, and it's just a rag status to be honest, and much of it is green and amber, so real progress being made, particularly on MAT standards 1 to 5, and then progress being made to 6 to 10, and then there's some challenges in there, particularly in rural areas or areas where there's a high incidence of issues that we need to face as well. So I'm seeing this moving on quite markedly now, and seeing it and hearing it and understanding it when I meet people, and they're understanding it too as well. I was asked a question the other day when I was in Blackburn on Monday about whether heat targets don't work well from a trauma-informed approach with MAT standards, and I'm going to take that away and look at it, because it might be we have already have frameworks of standards where they don't quite work well together, and I'm going to have a look at that and see how we can use the MAT standards to push much of that forward in a much more modern, you know, way.
Thank you for that answer. I mean, so you would expect to see progress in terms of the benchmarking that will come out in summer, firstly, and secondly, in terms of those challenges that were presented to us this morning, particularly around things like same-day prescribing not working as effectively as it should do. But also, I think the comment that was made quite clearly about they will be embedded when essentially people who are, you know, on the ground living this experience and their families feel that there has been demonstrable progress on things like same-day prescribing. So are you going to look at that in a specific action and obviously as a result of what comes out in the benchmarking to further develop that?
So we're keeping track of what's happening in each area across Scotland, and where we're seeing some challenges, people are then, the organisations are then coming forward for monthly reporting so that we can give advice and support and guidance on a monthly basis to push forward the progress on all of that. There's a number of areas that have shifted from monthly to quarterly and quarterly back to monthly, depending on where they are in the progress chart here. But there are many areas are taking advantage of that opportunity to work with us on that monthly basis when reporting their progress on the standards. So I will continue to do that.
Thank you.
And Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Convener. And a question of interest as a practising NHS GP. Minister, I'm so glad to hear that you support recovery and eventually rehab for those who certainly want it and are asking for it. So can I ask, do you agree with Justina Murray from the last panel who said rehab is actually damaging the implementation of reducing drug harm?
Sorry, I never heard that last bit.
Do you agree with Justina Murray from the last panel who said rehab is actually damaging the implementation of reducing drug harm?
So I'm very aware that Justina's sitting right behind me. Actually, yes, she's gone. She's gone. Sorry. I'll catch up with her soon. Justina's been an absolutely superb advocate for this area and speaking to me and how we do that. I'll have to go away and look at what she was saying in that, because I didn't catch that bit of the committee this morning. But I'll go back to the point that I made to Mr Finlay earlier, is that we have to ensure that we have got a number of pathways available for people so that they have got the choice for the pathway that works for them. You know, and I said earlier, you know, we get pulled in all different directions because some people think that pathway is the best one and other people think another pathway is the best one. So I think our responsibility is to create that choice for people to understand the pathway that works for them. And when I met people yesterday at Abicare, they were saying to me, you know, there was two people that I met who are currently in an abstinence programme in a rehab facility, who said, we tried that and we tried that. And both of them had actually tried the two same things, but it hadn't worked for them, but this had. And I think that's important, to understand where the challenges are coming from our stakeholders who are, used to say, doing amazing work and their ideas about what they think works best. I think we need to take all of that on board. But I think from my point of view, the responsibility is to create the choice that allows people to have the pathway and the person-centred approach.
Absolutely.
That
so choice is important. And those who seek help, certainly getting the help that they're asking for. And just like you, I have visited and spoken to people in Rainbow House in Glasgow, who offer peer support in a residential rehab setting, and an innovative Glasgow rehab programme, one of the first to be set up, which was actually a peer support, but out into the community. Both are extremely concerned about their funding. And if you look at Rainbow House, the volunteers, who are the peer support volunteers, they cannot speak highly enough of what they can do to help others. So do you think we have enough money going into rehab?
So I think the argument would be there's never enough money, is there? I think from my perspective and coming into this role, the increase in funding from Scottish Government to ADPs and other support agencies and the work that they do is up 67%. So I think that tells you there's a real commitment here to drive more money into the system to ensure that we get the outcomes that we all want to see. A record £112 million last year in total for ADPs. The allocations for budgets for budgets right now are being set now, and the First Minister you know, has said publicly that this budget is protected. So we have seen increased funding coming into this budget. We have seen the impact of that. I think we're about to see over 100 additional residential rehab placements coming into play very, very soon. And we've also seen the investment in workforce. So that traineeship that we were at, I was at the other week with the work that the Scottish Drugs Forum are doing around that, and the Scottish Recovery Consortium and the work that they're doing both in prisons and in communities and all of that. I want to see them funded. I want to see them funded well. I will fight the corner in government in a really, really difficult funding situation. But we have seen that rise in funding, and we have seen that just commitment.
With the funding that you are putting in place, are we able to, or would you be able to, and your department, audit exactly where that money is being spent? Because, for example, Glasgow's HSCP is going to have significant cuts in rehab and services for children living with drug users.
So I've been very, very clear that the money that goes into the system via local authorities from the Scottish Government for ADPs is going to ADPs. I've been very, very clear about that. I don't think I could be any more clear. But also, you know, we do have challenges in the budget. Everyone's having challenges in the budget. And, you know, some of those challenges are not of our making. But, you know, I know from this point of view that we have had a 67% increase in budgets.
Sorry, my question was, would we be able to audit? Would you be able to audit to see exactly where that money is being spent and how the ADPs have increased their spend to the tune of what you're giving them?
So we've already did that, and I can surely make sure that the committee gets that report, because the report was published, I think, at the end of the year. Is that right? End of last year? The report was published where we audited where funding went to, particularly around about services like residential rehab and other services, where we did audit all of that. And there was a concern about underspends and the way that we were able to allow underspends to go back into the system and be spent on things that were the priorities for here. But that report's published, and we can get that to you.
Thank you. And my final question, Dr. Sakit, can I ask, especially with Glasgow having a very diverse community, and maybe you haven't got time to give me a full answer, you could possibly write, but do you have policies and things in place to help people from an ethnic background when it comes to substance misuse?
Yeah. So you're right. We have certainly particular pockets of our communities in Glasgow where we have a high prevalence of people from minority ethnic groups. We have had specialist services for them in South Glasgow, for example. There was a BAME ADRS service for a while. It has been more mainstreamed recently. What we find is when we look at our caseloads, the caseloads are predominantly white, Scottish. I mean, more than 90-odd percent. We have been looking in the wider mental health system about how we meet the needs of people from minority ethnic groups in different populations. And I think that is an area that our ADP has been trying to progress. But I can't give you a current action plan around that, but we recognise that as a developmental need within the ADP. I do want to go back just a little bit, if I can, and just say that very quickly, that Glasgow has always commissioned residential rehab beds. It has the 16-bedded unit that you visited is commissioned by Alcohol and Drug Services. And in addition to that, with the new monies, we've actually added seven new beds from which we purchased from Phoenix. So actually, the residential rehab service offered to our caseload is increasing and has been for the last few years.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, that's us just a little bit over time, but I'd just like to thank all our witnesses. Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Dr. Priyadarshi, this morning. That's been a very informative session. So thank you again. And that completes the public part of our meeting. We'll now move into private session. Thank you.